I forgot to fucking... God damn it. Yeah, nobody's here, so... Giftuber. Working... on comps. Whoa. Oh, oh. Working on commissions. Yeah. I want to watch this video, but I need to start streaming.
I'm going to teach you about evil. Evil is an extremely broad concept that's described as the opposite of good, which is an equally broad concept. From my perspective, after a lot of research on the subject, evil isn't something you should use to describe someone. Now, your first thought, looking at a villain, is to say, well, that is an evil person. But evil, as the opposite of good, is an action. Some people would call these actions sins. But at the core of every biblical sin, even beyond the action's intent, is the outcome. Evil is an action taken that puts those around you in a state of tribulation. Now, any hero can make a good or evil choice, and an action can indirectly decide the fate of all those around them. I'd argue that everyone misunderstands evil due to the theory of indeterminacy. Just like light and dark, one can't exist without the other. People who endure the tribulations better understand the contrast and become a paragon of what they perceive. Well, that's the end of my philosophical essay on evil, but let's build a villain. Step one, to divert your expectations, is to make a hero, a strong idealist who believes in all the good the world has to offer, but has suffered little to no tribulations yet. I wrote a screenplay a couple years ago that I didn't do anything with, but it's a good example to use. The first of my heroes is a scientist, James Hinton. The second is a war hero.
Get that Alan off Wilson. The screen.
And the third is a businessman, Winston Mandrago. As part of this step, describe your hero's ideals, their ambitions, and what motivates them. James Hinton is a genius experimental physicist. He values innovation, creation, and freedom. I initially based him on myself. His current ambition is to create dimensional portals, a debunked field of what peers would call pseudoscience. His motivator is fear. Fear is the most valuable emotion that humans have, and the most common drive, be it a fear of failure, of the unknown, death, isolation, or one of its other many angles. The best among us are driven to learn, so they find solace from their fears. Alan values altruism, companionship, and family. His ambitions are to meet his father's expectations of adding good to the world. And his motivator, at this time, is also a fear of disappointing those that he values. Lastly, we have Winston. He values power, intelligence, and wealth to fuel the world's future. His ambitions are somewhat self-centered, but you can't really blame him. He has a vision for a better world, and is confident that only he can shepherd its arrival. His motivator is slightly more unique, as it isn't centered on the unknown. He has hope, a hope for the world to improve its own bounty so that suffering, war, and starvation come to an end. Respectable people with righteous ambitions. Now let's completely fuck them up with cause and effect. Sometimes evil surfaces not from actions, but from probability. The most common causes of evil actions are mental dispositions, jealousy, desperation, insecurity, selfishness, and most types of fear. Now, to really make a villain, we need at least one of the following things to happen. Have their number of evil deeds be greater than that of their good deeds. Most villains like this have the ends justify the means mentality. Have one greatly evil deed overshadow all others. Spread a rumor that tarnishes their name, forcing them to act on insecurity. Overwhelm them with jealousy or desperation, or amplify their selfish indulgences. You'll notice, before I twist my subjects, that they have the same goals as your average party. That's my lesson in this video if you haven't caught on. There's no such thing as a villain or an evil person, but regardless, let's start with Mr. Hinton. Due to his research being more or less debunked, he faces failure at nearly every turn. Terrified of failure, deeply in debt, with nowhere to turn, he becomes overwhelmed with desperation. This is his first snap. To cope with loneliness and amplify his fear, he develops minor schizophrenia and begins to lose touch with reality. As the story would progress, this mental twist allows him to make real strides in his research and earn a large grant from his friend Alan. A little note here, the more entwined your heroes are with your villains, the more fulfilling the conflict. Oftentimes, both the heroes and the villains will have identical goals, which makes them butting heads a lot more realistic. After isolating himself to complete his research, James completely loses humanity. His reasoning would be something along the lines of, "If no one appreciates my work, and they all live to mock me, why should I even consider them?" This is his final snap. By far the most important angle in a villain is their misunderstanding of the world. Reaching one wrong conclusion about the world alienates you from the truth, and greatly shifts your moral compass. Before we analyze his current, greatly evil actions and plans, let's look at our other victims of author-forced tragedy. Winston is a visionary, on par with people like Elon Musk or Bill Gates, who sees what the world can gain and actively tries to provide it. But his overwhelming awareness of his short mortal life is the crux of his eventual snap. A man with such a powerful vision can't afford to lose even a second of time or money. Incidentally, he turns away James's proposal for an absurd field of science. Now, indirectly, this is his first snap. After hearing about Hinton's success, he's overwhelmed with the regret of not funding it and owning the patent. This is another important note, as people can be brought to take dark actions not out of desperation, but also regrets. I'll describe his first insurmountably evil action in just a moment. Let's move on to my third hero, Alan. Alan is a recently returned hero of war, whose wealthy father recently passed away. Hoping to help the world, but not knowing how, he offers his inheritance to an old friend, James. His actions for now are nothing but loving, kind, and humble. He builds a new life, a family, and a company of his own. This, right here, is what can easily lead someone down the path of evil. Having so much to be grateful for is the same as having so much to lose. Winston sees Alan as a threat to his plans for the future, an encroaching evil person who might shape the world in a different way. His selfishness eventually becomes his downfall as Winston lashes out in desperation. In an attempt to eliminate the competition and drop the funding, he destroys everything Alan owns. Alan, at this point, is our most tragic villain, and some could see him as an anti-hero. But, as I said before, there's no such thing as a villain, or a hero, or an anti-hero. Just people living lives and doing what they think is right. Losing the entire world provides Alan with a motivator I've kept hidden from you until now. Revenge. Any good man can be vengeful if he loses his future. Keep that in mind, just in general. His life turns into a vigilante-style assault on Winston's way of life. Winston begins funding our twisted friend who sequestered himself from the world to finish his project. To keep his attack on Alan a secret and avoid more issues, Winston takes increasingly evil actions to save his own face. You could say, from his perspective, the ends justify the means. I might have lost some of you telling a story as opposed to giving bullet points, but now we have three perfectly crafted men who act evilly without hesitation. From my point of view, there are three details you need to truly understand where these people are now, how far they'll go, when they'll stop, and how they further their plans. To answer the first prompt, ask yourself what your villain values. What do they have to lose, if anything? Are they sworn by something on their own accord? Let's look at Winston to answer this. He's become somewhat of a Machiavellian, and is very adept at manipulating others for personal gain. So he doesn't value relationships. He's lost sight of his generosity as it's been clouded by fear. Fear of losing his wealth and his name. No matter what, he'll sacrifice anything but how people perceive him, and his investment in jail. To answer the second prompt,
thank you for the lord.
He has one emotionally blinded goal: destroy Winston's reputation and then kill him. My favorite thing about this particular type of progression is once he's finally done, Alan risks becoming identical to the person he hates. Hunting monsters can turn a weak soul into a monster, and someone with a vengeance is the perfect candidate. And the last detail for any villain, which is the most important thing for telling your story, is how they achieve their goal. This is generally the only thing most people actually write. I'll use my crippled and shattered soul and mind, James Hinton. The most powerful social influence.
Hello, time enjoyed. I'm just eating peanuts.
Hinton has none of that, and that makes him more terrifying than any evil overlord. He's no longer human. He's an isolated host of demons that are amplified.
You got post nuked.
In order
to
do his research, he needs living subjects.
Where was that?
Lack of
in memes
and insomnia. Delirium becomes both his only friend and his deadliest enemy. Initially, the only external effects he has are random disappearances and kidnappings in the local area. As a slave to his fears, his research, and his demons, he becomes more and more unpredictable and monstrous. Eventually, he could risk psychopathic outrages, attacking people with powerful advanced weapons simply as a disillusioned form of revenge for all the rejection he faced. Anyone can become a villain. All it takes is a little tribulation.
General. Oh, okay. I was like, why would he get rid of the meme? It's a meme. It a meme.
Marg had already had a lot of wine.
AFK more.
Was very red. Just a small one then, she chuckled. A bit more than that, and a bit more. That's the boy. Dudley was eating his fourth slice of pie. Aunt Petunia was sipping coffee with her little finger sticking out. Harry really wanted to disappear into his bedroom, but he met Uncle Vernon's angry little eyes and knew he would have to sit it out. Ah, said Aunt Marg, smacking her lips and putting the empty...
Even. If you want good music, I got some right here. I forgot how good this song was. I didn't forget. I knew it was good. All the music from Metal Gear Rising Revengeance is so good. That game is supposed to be a joke.
The brandy glass back down. Excellent.
That game is supposed to be a fucking joke. It's supposed to be a meme. It even says it's a meme. It says it in the game.
Pardon me, but I do like to see a healthy sized boy, she went on, winking at Dudley. You'll be a proper sized man, Dudders, like your father. Yes, I'll have a spot more brandy, Vernon. Now, this one here. She jerked her head at Harry. He felt his stomach clench. The handbook, he thought quickly. The one, this one's got a mean runty.
I just need to play it though. I'm sorry. I know you're probably busy with other things. You're probably busy with other things. I just wanted to play it. I know that you're busy with other things. You're probably in the middle of shit.
You look about him. You get that with dogs. I had Colonel Clubstow drown one last year. Ratty was the thing it was. Weak. Underbred. Harry was trying to remember page 12 of his book, A Charm to Cure Reluctant Reverses. It all comes down to blood. As I was saying the other day, bad blood will out. Now, I'm saying nothing against your family, Petunia. She patted Aunt Petunia's bony hand with her shovel-like one. But your sister was a bad egg. They turn up in the best families. Then she ran off with a wastrel, and here's the result right in front of us. Harry was staring at his plate, a funny ringing in his ears. Grasped a broom firmly by the tail, he thought, but he couldn't remember what came next. Aunt Marv's voice seemed to be boring into him, like one of Uncle Vernon's drills. "This Potter," said Aunt Marv loudly, seizing the brandy bottle and splashing more into her glass and over the tablecloth. "You never told me what he did." Uncle Vernon and Aunt Petunia were looking extremely tense. Dudley had even looked up from his pie to gape at his parents. He didn't work," said Uncle Vernon, with half a glance at Harry. "Unemployed." "As I expected," said Aunt Marv, taking a huge swig of brandy and wiping her chin on her sleeve. "A no-account, good-for-nothing, lazy scrounger who he was not," said Harry suddenly. The table went very quiet. Harry was shaking all over. He had never felt so angry in his life. More brandy!" yelled Uncle Vernon, who had gone very white. He emptied the bottle into Aunt Marg's glass. You boy," he snarled at Harry. "Go to bed. Go on." "No, Vernon," hiccuped Aunt Marg, holding up a hand, her tiny bloodshot eyes fixed on Harry's. "Go on, boy. Go on. Proud of your parents, are you? They go and get themselves killed in a car crash. Drunk, I expect. They didn't die in a car crash," said Harry.
"That's a good question. Where am I?
They died in a car crash, you nasty little liar, and left you to be a burden on their decent, hard-working relatives," screamed Aunt Marg, swelling with fury. "You are an insolent, ungrateful little..." But Aunt Marg suddenly stopped speaking. For a moment, it looked as though words had failed her. She seemed to be swelling with an inexpressible anger. But the swelling didn't stop. Her great red face started to expand.
"I'm no one's dad.
Eyes bulged,
and her mouth I'm no one's dad.
To speak. Next second, several buttons burst from her tweed jacket and pinged off the wall.
"I'm no one's dad, but also..."
Like a monstrous balloon. Her stomach burst.
"Hope everybody's having a good day."
Each of her fingers blowing up like a salami. "Marg!" yelled Uncle Vernon and Aunt Petunia together, as Aunt Marg's whole body began to rise off her chair towards the ceiling. She was entirely round now, like a vast light boy with piggy eyes, and her hands and feet stuck out weirdly as she drifted up into the air, making apologetic popping noises. Ripper came skidding into the room, barking madly. "No!" Uncle Vernon seized one of Marg's feet and tried to pull her down again, but was almost lifted from the floor himself. Next second, Ripper had leapt forward and sunk his teeth into Uncle Vernon's leg.
Harry on way to works, we'll be semi-lurking. No!
The cupboard door burst magically open as he reached it. In seconds, he had heaved his trunk to the front door. He sprinted upstairs and threw himself under the bed, wrenched up the loose floorboard, and grabbed the pillowcase full of his books and birthday presents. He wriggled out, seized Hedwig's empty cage, and dashed back downstairs to his trunk. Just as Uncle Vernon burst out of the dining room, his trouser leg in bloody tatters. "Come back in here," he bellowed. "Come back and put her right." But a reckless cage had come over Harry. Rage had come over Harry. He kicked his trunk open.
A reckless rage.
And pointed it to Uncle Vernon. "She deserved it," Harry said, breathing very fast. "She deserved what she got. You keep away from me." He fumbled behind him for the catch on the door. "I'm going," Harry said. "I've had enough." And next moment, he was out in the dark, quiet street, heaving his heavy trunk behind him, Hedwig's cage under his arm. Harry was several streets away before he collapsed onto a low wall in Magnolia Crescent, panting from the effort of dragging his trunk. He sat quite still, anger still surging through him, listening to the frantic pumping of his heart. But after 10 minutes alone in the dark street, a new emotion overtook him, panic. Whichever way he looked at it, he had never been in a worse fix. He was stranded, quite alone, in a dark muggle world, with absolutely nowhere to go. And the worst of it was, he had just done serious magic, which meant that he was almost certainly expelled from Hogwarts. He had broken the decree for the restriction of underage wizardry so badly, he was surprised Ministry of Magic representatives weren't swooping down on him where he sat. Harry shivered and looked up and down Magnolia Crescent. What was going to happen to him? Would he be arrested? Or would he simply be outlawed from the wizarding world? He thought of Ron and Hermione, and his heart sank even lower. Harry was sure that, criminal or not, Ron and Hermione would want to help him now, but they were both abroad, and with Hedwig gone, he had no means of contacting them. He didn't have any muggle money either. There was a little wizard gold in the money bag at the bottom of his trunk, but the rest of his fortune his parents had left him was stored in a vault at Gringotts, Wizarding Bank in London. He'd never be able to drag his trunk all the way to London, and left. He looked down at his wand, which he was still clutching in his hand. If he was already expelled, his heart was now thumping painfully fast. A bit more magic couldn't hurt. He had the invisibility cloak he had inherited from his father. What if he bewitched the trunk to make it feather-like, tied it to his broomstick, covered himself in a cloak, and flew to London? Then he'd get the rest of the money out of his vault and begin his life as an outcast. It was a horrible prospect, but he couldn't sit on this wall forever, or he'd find himself trying to explain to Muggle police why he was out in the dead of night with a trunkful of spellbooks and a broomstick. Harry opened his trunk again and pushed the contents aside, looking for the invisibility cloak. But before he had found it, he straightened up suddenly, looking around him once more.
I'm just eating my Cajun's peanuts right now.
He was being watched. But the street
appeared. That's all I'm doing.
And no light from any of the hot, warehouses.
Spicy hot Cajun peanuts. I'm just listening to Harry Potter.
Someone or something was standing in the narrow gap between the garage and the fence behind him. Harry squinted at the back
of the garage.
If only it would move, then he'd know whether it was just a stray cat or something else. Loomis, Harry muttered, and a light appeared at the end of his wand, almost dazzling him. He held it high over his head, and the pebble-dashed walls of number 2 suddenly sparkled. The garage door gleamed, and between them Harry saw, quite distinctly, the hulking outline of something very big, with wide, gleaming eyes. Harry stepped backwards. His legs hit his trunk, and he tripped. His wand flew out of his hand as he flung out an arm to break his fall, and he landed hard in the gutter. There was a deafening bang, and Harry threw up his hands to shield his eyes against a sudden blinding light. With a yell, he rolled back onto the pavement just in time. A second
what?
Later,
you're not looking forward to work? How could you not?
To a halt exactly where Harry had just been lying. They belonged, as Harry saw when he raised his head, to a triple-decker, violently purple bus, which had appeared out of thin air. Gold lettering over the windscreen spelled the Night Bus. For a split second, Harry wondered if he'd been knocked silly by his fall. And then a conductor in purple uniform leapt out of the bus and began to speak loudly to the knight. Welcome to the Night Bus, emergency transport for the stranded witch or wizard. Just stick out your wand hand, step on board, and we can take you anywhere you want to go. My name is Stan Shunpike, and I will be your conductor this evening. The conductor stopped abruptly. He had just caught sight of Harry, who was still sitting on the ground. Harry snatched up his wand again and scrambled to his feet. Close to, he saw that Stan Shunpike was only a few years older than he was, 18 or 19 at most.
No, just work sucks, I assume.
What are you doing down there? Said Stan, dropping his professional manner. Fell over, said Harry. She fell over for, niggered Stan. I didn't do it on purpose, said Harry, annoyed. One of the knees in his jeans was torn, and the hand he had thrown out to break his fall was bleeding. He suddenly remembered why he'd fallen over, and turned around quickly to stare at the alleyway between the garage and the fence. The night bus's headlamps were flooding it with light, and it was empty. What are you looking at? Said Stan. There was a big black thing, said Harry, pointing uncertainly into the gap. Like a dog, but massive. He looked around at Stan, whose mouth was slightly open. With a feeling of unease, Harry saw Stan's eyes move to the scar on Harry's forehead. What's that on your head? Said Stan abruptly. Nothing, said Harry quickly, flattening his hair over his scar. If the Ministry of Magic was looking for him, he didn't want to make it too easy for them. What's your name? Stan persisted. Neville Longbottom, said Harry, saying the first name that came into his head. So this bus, he went on quickly, hoping to distract Stan. Did you say it goes anywhere?
I'm not.
Yeah, said Stan proudly. Anywhere you like, long as it's on land.
No.
Can't do nothing underwater.
Sounds like a pain in the ass to me.
Looking suspicious again.
Take care.
You did flag us down, didn't you? Stuck out your wand, didn't you? Yes, said Harry quickly. Listen, how much would it be to get to London? 11 sickles, said Stan. But for 13, you can get hot chocolate, and for 15, you can get a hot water bottle and a toothbrush in the colour of your choice. Harry rummaged once more in the trunk, extracted his money bag, and shoved some silver into Stan's hand. He and Stan then lifted his trunk, with Hedwig's cage balanced on top, up the steps of the bus. There were no seats. Instead, half a dozen brass bedsteads stood beside the
I just
candles were burning in brackets beside each bed.
It's everyone's right.
The wood paneled walls.
It's everyone's right to do whatever they want.
Not now, thanks. on pickling some slugs.
Just rolled over in his sleep. As long as it's not you bothering anybody.
Dan whispered, shoving Harry's trunk under
the if bed. If it makes it a pain to go to work, that's when I'm like, don't get in my face, man.
This is our driver, Ernie Prang. This is Neville Longbottom, man. Ernie Prang, an elderly wizard wearing very thick
glasses, get in my face, man.
To Harry, who nervously flattened his fringe again and sat down on his bed. Take her away, Ern, said Stan, sitting down.
I'm very much,
next to Ernie's.
You know,
it was another tremendous
long, do whatever you want, as long as you're not in other people's faces. I don't give a shit.
Thrown backwards by the speed of the night bus. Pulling himself up, Harry stared out of the dark window and saw that they were now...
If you're going to protest, just don't do it in my face.
...along a completely different street. Sam was watching Harry's stunned face with great enjoyment. This is where we was before you fled this town, he said. Where are we, Ern? Somewhere in Wales? Arr, said Ernie.
Yeah.
How can the muggles don't hear the bus, said Harry. Then, said Stan contemptuously, don't listen properly, do they? Don't look properly either. Never notice nothing. They don't. Best go wake up Madame Marsh, Stan, said Ern. We'll be in Abergavenny in a minute. Stan passed Harry's bed and disappeared up a narrow wooden staircase. Harry was still looking out the window, feeling increasingly nervous. Ernie didn't seem to have mastered the use of the steering wheel. The night bus kept mounting the pavement, and it didn't hit anything. Lines of lampposts, letterboxes, and bins jumped out of its way as it approached and back into position once it had passed. Stan came back downstairs.
Exactly. Don't do that. Don't scream in people's faces. Just leave people alone. Just leave people. Either way, just leave people alone. You have every right to say whatever you want. Just don't say it in my face. Like, just keep away.
And they were thundering down a narrow...
Like if people were being like, hey, pro-vaccine, and then yelling in my face about it, I'd be like, get the fuck out of my face. I don't care. Get out of my face. I don't like it. I don't like people in my personal space.
A whole copy of the Daily Prophet and was now reading.
And if you're like, we're going to do it in front of this building, what did the building do? Nothing. Oh, okay. So you decided here.
He was on the Muggle News. Stanley turned to the front page and chuckled. Sirius Black, he said, nodding. Of course he was on the Muggle News, Neville. Where you been? He gave a superior sort of chuckle at the blank look on Harry's face, removed the front page, and handed it to Harry. You ought to read the papers more, Neville. Harry held the paper up to the candlelight and read. Black still at large. Sirius Black, possibly the most infamous prisoner ever to be held in Azkaban Fortress, is still eluding capture, the Ministry of Magic confirmed today. We are doing all we can to recapture Black, said the Minister for Magic, Cornelius Fudge, this morning. And we beg the magical community to remain calm. Fudge has been criticised by some members of the International Federation of Warlocks for informing the Muggle Prime Minister of the crisis. Well, really, I had to. Don't you know, said an irritable Fudge. Black is mad. He's a danger to anyone who crosses him, magic or muggle. I have the Prime Minister's assurance that he will not breathe a word of Black's true identity to anyone. And let's face it, who believe him if he did? While muggles have been told that Black is carrying a gun, a kind of metal wand which muggles use to kill each other, the magical community lives in fear of a massacre like that of 12 years ago when Black murdered 13 people with a single curse. Harry looked into the shadowed eyes of Sirius Black, the only part of the sunken face that seemed alive. Harry had never met a vampire, but he had seen pictures of them in his Defense Against the Dark Arts classes. And Black...
They're bringing through the whole center, and the noise they make is atrocious. Late time, and we had to put the shutters down to protect customers. Damn.
13 people, said Harry, handing the page back to Stan. With one curse. Yep, said Stan, in front of witnesses and all. Broad daylight. Big trouble it caused. Didn't it, Ern? Arr. Said Ern darkly. Stan swiveled in his armchair, his hands on the back, the better to look at Harry. Black was a big...
I just don't want people in other people's faces. It's not cool.
Voldemort, said Harry, without thinking. Even Stan's pimples went white. Ern jerked the steering wheel so hard that the whole farmhouse had to jump aside to avoid the bus. You out your tree, yelped Stan. What you say his name for? Sorry, said Harry hastily. Sorry, I forgot. Forgot? Said Stan weakly. Blimey, my heart's going that fast. So Black was a supporter of you-know-who, Harry prompted apologetically. Yeah, said Stan, still rubbing his chest. Yeah, that's right. Very close to you-know-who, they say. Anyway, when little Harry Potter put paid to you-know-who, Harry nervously flattened his fringe down again, all you-know-who supporters was tracked down, wasn't they, Ern? Most of them knew it was all over with you-know-who gone. And they came quiet, but not Sirius Black. I heard he thought he'd been second in command once, you know, who had taken over. Anyway, they cornered Black in the middle of a street full of muggles, and Black took out its wand, and he blasted half the street apart. And a wizard got it, and so did a dozen muggles who got in the way. Horrible, eh? And you know what Black did then? Stan continued in a dramatic whisper. What, said Harry? Laugh, said Stan. Just stood there and laughed. And when reinforcements from the Ministry of Magic got there, he went with them quiet as anything, still laughing his head off, because he's mad, isn't he, Ern? Isn't he mad? If he weren't when he went to Azkaban, he will be now, said Ern in his slow voice. I blow myself up before I set foot in that place. Serves him right, mind, after what he did. They had a job covering it, didn't they, Ern? Stan said. Old street blown up, all them muggles dead. What was it they said had happened, Ern? Gas explosion, grunted Ernie. Oh, now that's it. He's out, said Stan, examining the newspaper picture of Black's warm face again. Never been a breakout from Azkaban before. Has there, Ern? Beats me how he did it. Frightening, eh, mind? I don't fancy his chances against them Azkaban guards, eh, Ern? Ernie suddenly shivered. Talk about something else, Stan. There's a good lad. Them Azkaban guards give me the collie wobbles. Stan put the paper away reluctantly, and Harry leant against the window of the night bus, feeling worse than ever. He couldn't help imagining what Stan might be telling his passenger in a few nights' time. Here, about that Harry Potter. Blew up his arm. We had him here on the night bus, didn't we, Ern? He was trying to run for it. He, Harry, had broken a wizard law just like Sirius Black. Was inflating Aunt Marg bad enough to land him in Azkaban? Harry didn't know anything about the wizard prison, though everyone he'd ever heard speak of it did so in the same fearful tone. Hagrid, the Hogwarts gamekeeper, had spent 2 months there only last year. Harry wouldn't soon forget the look of terror on Hagrid's face when he'd been told where he was going, and Hagrid was one of the bravest people Harry knew. The night bus rolled through the darkness,
scattering
bushes and bollards, telephone boxes and trees. And Harry lay
you got me. And miserable. You got and me, and you got Harry
After
Potter.
After a while, Stan remembered that Harry had paid for hot chocolate, but poured it all over Harry's pillow when the bus moved abruptly from Anglesey to Aberdeen. One by one, wizards and witches in dressing gowns and slippers descended from the upper floors to leave the bus. They all looked very pleased to go. Finally, Harry was the only passenger left. Right then, Neville, said Stan, clapping his hands. Whereabouts in London? Diagon Alley, said Harry. Righto, said Stan. Hold tight then. Bang! They were thundering along Charing Cross Road. Harry sat up and watched buildings and benches squeezing themselves out of the night bus's way. The sky was getting a little lighter. He would lie low for a couple of hours, go to Gringotts the moment it opened, and then set off. Where? He didn't know. Ern slammed on the brakes and the night bus skidded to a halt in front of the small and shabby-looking pub, the Leaky Cauldron, behind which lay the
Diagon
Alley. Thanks, Harry said to
Ern. Oh, Heben, did you hear about Harry Potter?
And Hedwig's cage onto the pavement.
Did you see the meme? Let's see if it's in a sound.
Pirate, you put your name in the cupboard of fire. Pirate, you put your name in the cupboard of fire.
He said calmly. No, I didn't.
Mother,
burn.
Dumbledore asked calmly.
Did you punch your name in the heart? 5 million points to Slytherin.
Well, said Harry. Sorry, then. Stan wasn't paying attention. Still standing in the doorway to the back, he was goggling at the shadowy entrance.
No, sir. No. It wasn't me.
There you are, Harry, said a voice. Before Harry could turn, he felt a hand on his shoulder. At the same time, Stan shouted, Blimey, Ern, come here! Come here! Harry looked up at the owner of the hand on the shoulder and felt a bucket of ice cascade into his stomach. He had walked right into Cornelius Fudge, the Minister for Magic himself. Stan leapt onto the pavement beside them.
I like the Harry for a furry one that then plays. I want to put you up first. I want to be a furry.
Neville, he repeated frowning. This is Harry Potter. I knew it, Stan shouted gleefully. Ern, guess who Neville is? Ern, he's Harry Potter. I can see his scar. Yes, said Fudge testily. Well, I'm very glad the night bus picked Harry up, but he and I need to step inside the leaky cauldron now. Fudge increased the pressure on Harry's shoulder, and Harry found himself being steered inside the pub. A stooping figure bearing a lantern appeared through the door behind the bar. It was Tom, the wizened, toothless landlord. You've got him, mister, said Tom. Will you be wanting anything? Beer? Brandy? Perhaps a pot of tea, said Fudge, who still hadn't let go of Harry. There was a loud scraping and puffing from behind them, and Stan and Ern appeared, carrying Harry's trunk in Hedwig's cage and looking around excitedly. How come you didn't tell us who you are, eh, Neville? Said Stan, beaming at Harry, while Ernie's owlish face appeared interestedly over Stan's shoulder. And a private parlour, please, Tom, said Fudge pointedly. Bye, Harry said miserably to Stan and Ern, as Tom beckoned Fudge towards the passage that led them from the bar. Bye, Neville, called Stan. Fudge marched Harry along the narrow passage after Tom's lantern, and then into a small parlour. Tom clicked his fingers. A fire burst into life in the grate, and he bowed himself out of the room. Sit down, Harry, said Fudge, indicating a chair by the fire. Harry sat down, feeling goosebumps rising up his arms, despite the glow of the fire. Fudge took off his pinstripe cloak and tossed it aside, then hitched up the trousers of his bottle green suit and sat
down. Is this a commission you're doing? Yes, it is commissioned for demonic.
The Minister for Magic. Harry already knew.
The reference pick is sucks real bad, but I'm trying my best.
The innkeeper reappeared, wearing an apron over his nightshirt and bearing a tray of tea and crumpets. He placed the tray on a table between Fudge and Harry.
I've never said that before about most, but this one is real difficult.
You've had us all in a right flap, I don't mind telling you. Running away from your aunt and uncle's house like that, I'd started to think, but you're safe, and that's what matters. Fudge buttered himself a crumpet and pushed the plate towards Harry. Eat, Harry. You look dead on your feet. Now then, you will be pleased to hear that we have dealt with the unfortunate blowing up of Miss Marjorie Dursley. Two members of the Accidental Magic Reversal Squad were dispatched to Privet Drive a few hours ago. Miss Dursley has been punctured, and her memory has been modified. She has no recollection of the incident at all, so that's that, and no harm done. Fudge smiled at Harry over the rim of his teacup, rather like an uncle surveying a favourite nephew. Harry, who couldn't believe his ears, opened his mouth to speak, couldn't think of anything to say, and closed it again. Ah, you're worrying about...
Oh, very nice. That's not so good. You can work your magic, though. You're a wizard, goat.
Harry, but
I'm doing pretty all right.
Next summer, as long as you stay at Hogwarts for the Christmas and Easter holidays. Harry unstuck his throat. I always stay at Hogwarts for the Christmas and Easter holidays, he said. And I don't want to ever go back to Privet Drive. Now, I'm sure you'll feel differently once you've calmed down, said Fudge in a worried tone. They are your family, after all, and I'm sure you are fond of each other. Very deep down. It didn't occur to Harry to put Fudge right. He was still waiting to hear what was going to happen to him right now. So, all that remains, said Fudge, now buttering himself a second crumpet, is to decide where you're going to spend the last 3 weeks of your holidays. I suggest you take a room here at the Leaky Cauldron and... Hang on, blurted Harry. What about my punishment? Fudge blinked. Punishment? I broke the law, Harry said, the decree for the restriction of underage wizardry. Oh, my dear boy, we're not going to punish you for a little thing like that, cried Fudge, waving his trumpet impatiently. It was an accident. We don't send people to Azkaban just for blowing up their aunt. But this didn't really tally at all with Harry's past dealings with the Ministry of Magic. Last year, I had an official warning just because a house elf smashed a pudding in my uncle's house, said Harry, frowning. The Ministry of Magic said I'd be expelled from Hogwarts if there was any more magic there. Unless Harry's eyes were deceiving him, Fudge was suddenly looking awkward. Circumstances change, Harry. We have to take into account in the present climate. Surely you don't want me to expel you. Of course I don't, said Harry. Well then, what's all the fuss about? Laughed Fudge airily. Now, have a crumpet, Harry, while I go and see if Tom's got a room for you. Fudge strode out of the parlour, and Harry stared after him. There was something extremely odd going on. Why had Fudge been waiting for him at the Leaky Cauldron, if not to punish him for what he'd done? And now Harry came to think of it. Surely it wasn't usual for the Minister of Magic himself to get involved in matters of underage magic. Fudge came back, accompanied by Tom, the innkeeper. Room 11's free, Harry, said Fudge. I think you'll be very comfortable. Just one thing, and I'm sure you'll understand. I don't want you wandering off into Muggle London, all right? Eat to Diagon Alley, and you're to be back here before dark each night. Sure you'll understand. Tom will be keeping an eye on out for you. For me. Okay, said Harry slowly. But why? Don't want to lose you again, do we? Said Fudge with a hearty laugh. No.
That's because you're special, Harry.
I mean, Fudge appeared.
You're Harry. It's now because you're special, Harry.
Well, I'll be
so
off.
Special.
You know, have you had any luck with Black yet? Harry asked. Fudge's fingers slipped on the silver fastenings of his coat. What's that? Oh, you've heard. Well, no, not yet. But it's only a matter of time. The Azkaban guards have never yet failed, and they are angrier than I've ever seen them. Fudge shuddered slightly. So, I'll say goodbye. He held out his hand, and Harry shaking it had a sudden idea. Minister, can I ask you something? Certainly, smiled Fudge. Well, third years at Hogwarts are allowed to visit Hogsmeade, but my aunt and uncle didn't sign the permission form. You think you could? Fudge was looking uncomfortable. Ah, he said, no, I'm very sorry, Harry, but as I'm not your parent or guardian, but you're the Minister for Magic, said Harry eagerly. If you give me permission... No, I'm sorry, Harry, but rules are rules, said Fudge flatly. Perhaps you'll be able to visit Hogsmeade next year. In fact, I think it'll be best if you don't. Yes. Well, I'll be off. Enjoy your stay, Harry. And with a last smile and a shake of Harry's hand, Fudge left the room. Tom now moved forward, beaming at Harry. You'll follow me, Mr. Potter, he said. I've already taken your things up. Harry followed Tom up the handsome wooden staircase to a door with a brass number 11 on it, which Tom unlocked and opened for him. Inside was a very comfortable-looking bed, some highly polished oak furniture, a cheerfully crackling fire, and perched on top of the wardrobe. Hedwig! Harry gasped. The snowy owl clicked her beak and fluttered down onto Harry's arm. Very smart owl you've got there, chuckled Tom. Arrived about 5 minutes after you did. If there's anything you need, Mr. Potter, don't hesitate to ask. He gave another bow and left. Harry sat on his bed for a long time, absent-mindedly stroking Hedwig. The sky outside the window was changing rapidly from deep, velvety blue to cold, steely grey, and then slowly to pink shot with gold. Harry could hardly believe that he'd only left Privet Drive a few hours ago, that he wasn't expelled, and that he was now facing three completely dirtly 3 weeks. It's been a very weird night, Hedwig, he yawned, and without even removing his glasses, he slumped back onto his pillows and fell asleep. It took Harry several days to get used to his strange new freedom. Never before had he been able to get up whenever he wanted or eat whatever he fancied. He could even go wherever he liked, as long as it was in Diagon Alley. And as to his long cobbled street, this cobbled street was packed with the most fascinating wizarding shops in the world. Harry felt no desire to break his word to Fudge and stray back into the Muggle world. Harry ate breakfast each morning in the Leaky Cauldron, where he liked watching the other guests. funny little witches from the country, up the day shopping, venerable-looking wizards arguing over the latest article in Transfiguration Today, wild-looking warlocks, raucous dwarfs, and once what looked suspiciously like a hag who ordered a plate of raw liver from behind a thick woolen balaclava. After breakfast, Harry would go out into the backyard, take out his wand, tap the third brick from the left above the dustbin, and stand back as the archway into Diagon Alley opened in the wall. Harry spent the long sunny days exploring the shop and eating under the brightly coloured umbrellas outside cafes, where his fellow diners were showing each other their purchases. It's a lunascope, old boy. No more messing around with moon charts, see? Or else discussing the case of Sirius Black. Personally, I wouldn't let any of the children out alone until he's back in Azkaban. Harry didn't have to do his homework under the blankets by torchlight anymore. Now he could sit in the bright sunshine outside Florian Fortescue's ice cream parlour, finishing all his essays with occasional help from Florian Fortescue himself, who, apart from knowing a great deal about medieval witch burnings, gave Harry free Sundays every half hour.
Hedwig is the best character. Hedwig is best girl. I'm sorry. The best girl is Hedwig.
He had to keep reminding himself that he had 5 years to go at Hogwarts.
When they ask who's the best girl in Harry Potter, Hedwig.
A wizarding game rather like marbles, in which the stones squirted a nasty smelling liquid into the other player's
Hedwig.
Face when they lost a point.
Avi.
He was sorely tempted to
Avi.
By the perfect moving model of
so what were you doing yesterday?
Game, which would have
I almost forgot to ask. What were you doing yesterday? I didn't see you.
The thing that tested Harry's resolution.
Not like you have to be here every day, even.
Quidditch supplies. A week after he'd arrived at the Leaky Cauldron, curious to know
it's
what
just you are.
The shop was staring at. Harry edged his way.
And when you're not. It makes me worry.
And squeezed in amongst the excited witches and wizards until he glimpsed the newly erected podium on which was mounted the most magnificent broom he had ever seen in his life. Just come out, prototype, a square-jawed wizard was telling his companion. It's the fastest broom in the world, isn't it, Dad? Squeaked the boy younger than Harry, who was swinging off his father's arm. Irish international side just put in an order for 7 of these beauties, the proprietor of the shop told the crowd, and their favourites for the World Cup. A large witch in front of Harry moved, and he was able to read the sign next to the broom, the Firebolt. This state-of-the-art racing broom sports a streamlined, superfine handle of ash, treated with a diamond-hard polish, and hand-numbered with its own registration number. Each individually selected birch twig in the broom tail has been honed to aerodynamic perfection, giving the Firebolt unsurpassable balance and pinpoint precision. The Firebolt has an acceleration of 0 to 150 miles an hour in 10 seconds and incorporates an unbreakable braking charm. Price on request. Price on request. Harry didn't like to think how much gold the Firebolt would cost. He had never wanted anything so much in his whole life, but he had never lost a Quidditch match on his Nimbus 2000. And what was the point in emptying his Gringotts vault for the Firebolt when he had a very good broom already? Harry didn't ask for the price, but he returned almost every day after that just to look at the Firebolt. There were, however, things that Harry needed to buy. He went to the apothecary to replenish his store of potions ingredients, and as his school robes were now several inches too short in the arm and leg, he visited Madame Malkin's robes for all occasions and bought new ones. Most important of all, he had to buy his new school books. Which would
had to work early as there was only me and one other staff member. Three off sick, damn.
As he looked in the bookshop window, instead of the usual display of gold embossed spellbooks the size of paving slabs, there was a large iron cage behind the glass which held about 100 copies of the Monster Book of Monsters. Torn pages were flying everywhere as the books grappled with each other, locked together in furious wrestling matches and snapping aggressively. Harry pulled his book list out of his pocket and consulted it for the first time. The Monster Book of Monsters was listed as the set book for care of magical creatures. Now Harry understood why Hagrid had said it would come in useful. He felt relieved. He'd been wondering whether Hagrid wanted help with some terrifying new pet. As Harry entered Flourish and Blotts, the manager came hurrying towards him.
I hate the what she did with Hagrid in this.
Yes, said Harry.
This book.
Get out of the way, said the manager impatiently.
I'm like, I wanted Hagrid to be happy forever and not have to deal with this shit.
Proceeded towards the door of the monster book's cage. Hang on, said Harry quickly. I've already got one of those. Have you? A look of enormous relief spread over the manager's face. Thank heavens for that. I've been bitten 5 times already this morning. A loud ripping noise rent the air. 2 of the monster books had seized a third and were pulling it apart. Stop it, cried the manager, poking the walking stick through the bars and knocking the books apart. I'm never stocking them again, never. It's been bedlam. I thought we'd seen the worst when we bought 200 copies of the Invisible Book of Invisibility. Cost a fortune and we never found them. Well, is there anything else I can help you with? Yes, said Harry, looking down his book list. I need Unfogging the Future by Cassandra Verblatsky.
Oh, yeah.
Starting divination, are you? Said the manager.
Fucking divination.
Harry into the back of the shop, where there was a corner devoted to fortune telling. A small table was stacked with volumes, such as Predicting the Unpredictable. Insulate yourself against shocks and broken balls. When fortunes turn foul. Here you are, said the manager, who had climbed a set of steps to take down a thick, black-bound book. Unfogging the Future. Very good guide to all your basic fortune-telling methods. Palmistry, crystal balls, bird entrails. But Harry wasn't listening. His eyes had fallen on another book, which was among a display on a small table. Death Omens. What to do when you know the worst is coming. Oh, I wouldn't read that if I were you, said the assistant lightly, looking to see what Harry was staring at. You'll start seeing death omens everywhere. It's enough to frighten anyone to death. But Harry continued to
stare. But did he get anything for Ron? No! Yeah, meant to be off today, but on way in after being in hospital till 3 a.m.
Anything else, he said. Yes, said Harry, tearing his eyes away from the dogs and dazedly consulting his book.
Help him, Bellbower.
Intermediate Transfiguration and the Standard Book of Spells, Grade 3.
Hope they feel better.
Harry emerged from Flourish and Blot 10 minutes later with his new books under his arm.
Hope I feel better.
He went back to the Leaky Cauldron, hardly noticing where he was going and bumping into several people. He tramped up the stairs up to his room, went inside and tipped his books onto his bed. Somebody had been in to tidy. The windows were open and the sun was pouring inside. Harry could hear the buses rolling by in the unseen Muggle street behind him, and the sound of the invisible crowd below in Diagon Alley. He caught sight of himself in the mirror over the basin. Can't have been a death omen, he told his reflection defiantly. I was panicking when I saw that thing in Mongolia Present. It was probably just a stray dog. He raised his hand automatically and tried to make his hair lie flat. You're fighting a losing battle there, dear, said the mirror in a wheezy voice. As the day slipped by, Harry started looking wherever he went for a sign of Ron or Hermione. Plenty of Hogwarts students were arriving in Diagon Alley now, with the start of term so near. Harry met Seamus Finnegan and Dean Thomas, his fellow Gryffindors, in Quality Quidditch Supplies, where they too were ogling the firebolt. He also ran into the real Neville Longbottom, a round-faced, forgetful boy, outside Flourish and Blot. Harry didn't stop to chat. Neville appeared to have mislaid his book list and was being told off by his very formidable-looking grandmother. Harry hoped she never found out that he pretended to be Neville while on the run from the Ministry of Magic. Harry woke on the last day of the holidays, thinking that he would at least meet Ron and Hermione tomorrow on the Hogwarts Express. He got up, dressed, went for the last look at the firebolt, and was just wondering where he'd have lunch when someone yelled his name and he turned. Harry! Harry! They were there, both of them, sitting outside.
You didn't get me any presents for my birthday! What about my fucking birthday, you bastard?
Finally, said Ron.
That's one thing that I never understood.
We went to the Leaky Cauldron.
It's like,
they said you'd left.
She makes an emphasis on Harry's birthday. That he never got a birthday until he went to Hogwarts.
Dad, said Ron simply.
But until he got his two best friends. Where the fuck is it? Oh, where's the present to Hagrid? Maybe to Hagrid, I can be like, you know, that's an older person. You know, he's like, no, don't do it. Like, I'd understand that, where he's like, well, you don't give presents to older men. That's weird, Harry. Well, just letting you know, it's very weird. Just having you guys hang out with me is weird enough. You can still get him a card.
Mr. Weasley, who worked at the Ministry of Magic, would of course
you could, the whole story, but he didn't.
Aunt Marg. Did you really blow up your aunt, Harry? Said Hermione in a very serious voice. I didn't didn't mean to, said Harry, while Ron roared with laughter. I just lost control. Not funny, Ron, said Hermione sharply. Honestly, I'm amazed Harry wasn't expelled. So am I, admitted Harry. He was expelled. I thought I was going to be arrested. He looked at Ron. But Dad didn't know why Fudge let me off, did he? Probably because it's you, isn't it? Said Jen. Still chuckling. Famous Harry Potter and all that. I'd hate to see what the Ministry would do to me if I blew up my aunt. Mind you, they'd have to dig me up first, because Mum would have killed me. Anyway, you can ask Dad yourself this evening. We're staying at the Leafy Cauldron tonight too. So, you can come to King's Cross with us tomorrow. Hermione's there as well. Hermione nodded, beaming. Mum and Dad dropped me off this morning with all my Hogwarts things.
He gets said nothing!
Harry happily. So,
it doesn't come off!
Your new books and stuff? Look at this, said Ron.
It never comes up!
Pulling a box out of her bag and opening it. Brand new wand, 14 inches, willow, containing one unicorn tail hair. And we've got all our books. He pointed at a large bag under his chair. What about those monster books, eh? The assistant nearly cried when we said we wanted two. What's all that, Hermione? Harry asked, pointing at not one, but three bulging bags in the chair next to her. Well, I'm taking more new subjects than you, aren't I? Said Hermione. Those are my books for arithmetic, care of magical creatures, divination, study of ancient runes, muggle studies. What are you doing muggle studies for? Said Ron, rolling his eyes at Harry. You're muggle born. Your mum and dad are muggles. You already know all about muggles. But it'll be fascinating to study them from the wizarding point of view, said Hermione earnestly. Are you planning to eat or sleep at all this year, Hermione? Asked Harry, while Ron sniggered. Hermione ignored them. I've still got 10 galleons, she said, checking her purse. It's my birthday in September, and Mum and Dad gave me some money to get myself an early birthday present. How about a nice book? Said Ron innocently. No, I don't think so, said Hermione composedly. I really want an owl. I mean, Harry's got Hedwig, and you've got Errol. I haven't, said Ron. Errol's a family owl, and all I've got is Scabbers. He pulled his pet rat out of his pocket. And I want to get him checked over, he added, placing Scabbers on the table in front of them. I don't think Egypt agreed with him. Scabbers was looking thinner than usual, and there was a definite droop to his whiskers. There's a magical creature shop just over there, said Harry, who knew Diagon Alley well by now. You can see if that they've got anything for Scabbers, and Hermione can get her owl. So, they paid for their ice creams and crossed the street to the magical menagerie. There wasn't much room inside. Every inch of wall was hidden by cages. It was smelly and very noisy because the occupants of these cages were all squeaking, squawking, jabbering or hissing. The witch behind the counter was already advising a wizard on the care of double-ended newts. So Harry, Ron and Hermione waited, examining the cages. A pair of enormous purple toads sat gulping wetly and feasting on dead blowflies. A gigantic tortoise with a jewel-encrusted shell was glittering near the window. Poisonous orange snails were oozing slowly up the side of a glass tank, and a fat white rabbit kept changing into a silk top hat and back again with a loud popping noise. Then there was
I would want that rabbit. Tank.
A noisy cage.
I'd have that rabbit.
Basket of funny
that rabbit would be mine.
They were humming loudly, and on the counter, a vast cage of sleek black rats, which were playing some sort of skipping game using their long, bald tails. The double-ended newt wizard left, and Ron approached the counter. It's my rat, he told the witch. He's been a bit off colour ever since I brought him back from Egypt. Bang him on the counter, said the witch.
That's very one-sided. Agreed. What is this bullshit, Harry? The bunnies. They need the pets.
Next to the cage of his fellow rat, who stopped their skipping tricks and scuffled to the wire for a better look. Like nearly everything Ron owned, Scabbers the rat was second-hand. He had once belonged to Ron's brother, Percy, and a bit battered. Next to the glossy rats in the cage, he looked especially woebegone. Hmm, said the witch, picking Scabbers up. How old is this rat? Dunno, said Ron. Quite old. He used to belong to my brother. What powers does he have? Said the witch, examining Scabbers closely. Said Ron. The truth was that Scabbers had never shown the faintest trace of interesting powers. The witch's eyes moved from Scabbers' tattered left ear to his front paw, which had a toe missing, and tutted loudly. He's been through the mill, this one, she said. He was like that when Percy gave him to me, said Ron defensively. An ordinary common or garden rat like this can't be expected to live longer than 3 years or so, said the witch. Now, if you were looking for something a bit more hard-wearing, you might like one of these. She indicated the black rat, who promptly started skipping again. Ron muttered, show off. Well, if you don't want a replacement, you can try this rat tonic, said the witch. reaching under the counter and bringing out a small red bottle.
Look at...
Okay, said Ron. How much?
Look at how awesome Ron is, even though we know... We know what's up with scabbards.
And then propelled itself...
Even though we know what's wrong with scabbards. Like, look how awesome Ron is. He's like, I don't want any new rats. I just want my old rat to be better. Like, I just want him, I hate him, kind of, but I also kind of love him. Just fix him. And she's like, oh, normal garden rat. Yeah, he's so fucking nice.
Madly at Scabbers. No, Crookshanks, no, cried the witch. But Scabbers shot from behind her hands like a bar of soap, landed splay-legged on the floor, and then scarpered for the door. Scabbers, Ron shouted, tearing out of the shop after him. Harry followed. It took them nearly 10 minutes to find Scabbers, who had taken refuge under a waste paper bin outside Quality Quidditch Supplies. Ron stuffed the trembling rat back into his pocket and straightened up, massaging his head. What was that? It was either a very big cat or quite a small tiger, said Harry. Where's Hermione? Probably getting her owl. They made their way back up to the crowded street to the magical menagerie. As they reached it, Hermione came out, but she wasn't carrying an owl. Her arms were clamped tightly around the enormous ginger cat. You bought that monster, said Ron, his mouth hanging open. He's gorgeous, isn't he? Said Hermione, glowing. That was a matter of opinion, thought Harry. The cat's ginger fur was thick and fluffy, but it was definitely a bit bow-legged, and its face looked grumpy and oddly squashed.
Oh,
it had run headlong.
Love that cat.
Now that Scabbers was out of sight, however, the cat was purring contentedly in Hermione's arms. Hermione, that thing nearly scalped me, said Ron. You didn't mean to, did you, Crookshanks? Said Hermione. And what about Scabbers? Said Ron, pointing at the lump in his chest pocket. He needs rest and relaxation. How's he going to get on with that thing around? That reminds me, you forgot your rat tonic, said Hermione, slapping the small red bottle into Ron's hand. And stop worrying. Crookshanks will be sleeping in my dormitory and Scabbers in yours. What's the problem? Poor Crookshanks. That witch said he'd been in there for ages. No one wanted him. I wonder why, said Ron sarcastically, as they set off towards the leafy cauldron.
Oh, big fat cat.
In the bar,
grumpy fat cats. They're so
Harry,
sweet
said,
and so cute. I love them.
How are you? Fine, thanks, said Harry. As he
they are also
Mr.
big fat cats are also
Mr.
good
Weasley
friends with rabbits.
The now familiar picture of Sirius Black staring up at him.
They're all, if you left, don't know, yeah, rabbits and big fat cats are real good friends.
Off our regular
job, you can make them besties.
Him, but no luck so far. Would we get a reward if we caught him? Asked Ron. It'd be good.
Or at least not
money.
Try to hunt each other.
Ridiculous, Ron, said Mr. Weasley, who on closer inspection looked very strange. Black's not going to be caught by a 13-year-old.
Cats and rabbits get along so well.
At that moment, Mrs. Weasley entered the bar, laden with shopping.
Because cats are like, oh, they're quiet. They won't annoy them. They won't annoy me. The rabbits are like, oh my god.
Youngest child and only girl.
Oh my dear god.
Ginny, who had always been very taken.
It's so loud.
Even more heartily embarrassed than usual when she saw him, perhaps because.
Bet the big fat cat would get you something for your birthday.
Percy, however, held out his hand as though he and Harry had never met and said, Harry, how nice to see you. Hello, Percy, said Harry, trying not to laugh. I hope you're well, said Percy pompously, shaking hands. It was rather like being introduced to the mayor. Very well, thanks. Harry, said Fred, elbowing Percy out of the way and bowing deeply. Simply splendid to see you, old boy. Marvellous, said George, pushing Fred aside and seizing Harry's hand in turn. Absolutely sniffing. Percy scowled.
We're just that's listening to Harry Potter.
Said
Fred. Your wizard, Harry.
Said Mrs. Weasley, depositing her shopping in the chair. Hello, Harry dear. I suppose you've heard our exciting news.
You're not shit, get the point of order.
No, sir. He said. Well,
5 million points to Cedric.
I don't doubt that, said Mrs. Weasley, frowning suddenly. I notice they haven't made you two prefects. What do we want to be prefects for, said George, looking revolted at the very idea. It'd take all the fun out of life. Ginny giggled. You want to see a better set a better example to your sister, snapped Mrs. Weasley. Ginny's got other brothers to set her an example, Mother, said Percy loftily. I'm going to change for dinner. He disappeared, and George heaved a sigh. We tried to shut him in a pyramid, he told Harry, but Mum spotted us. Dinner that night was a very enjoyable affair. Tom, the innkeeper, put three tables together in the parlour, and the seven Weasleys, Harry and Hermione, ate their way through five delicious courses.
Yeah, and Hermione's family and parents weren't there?
Asked Fred, as they tucked into a
I don't know. If I was Hermione's parents, I'd be fucking enamored by everything. I'd be like, oh,
a humongous big head, said Fred. Everyone is Mrs. Weasley.
I guess it's just, it's so hard. I guess it's just really hard to write multiple characters in a scene. But, like, it just bothers me that they're not around. Like, if they actually are like, oh my gosh, Hermione is amazing, then they would be around way more. I mean, I would be proud.
Percy asked again in a dignified
I'd be like,
way.
Have you seen
well,
our daughter?
As we haven't got
she's
one
fucking
anymore,
amazing.
Mr. Weasley, and as I work there, they're doing me a favor. His voice was casual, but Harry couldn't help noticing that Mr. Weasley's ears had gone red, just like Ron's did when he was under pressure. Good job too, said Mrs. Weasley briskly. Do you realize how much luggage you've all got between you? A nice sight you'd be on the Muggle Underground. You are all packed, aren't you? Ron hasn't put all his new things in his trunk yet, said Percy in a long-suffering voice. He's dumped them on my bed. You better go and pack properly, Ron, because we won't have much time in the morning. Mrs. Weasley called down the table. Ron scowled at Percy. After dinner, everyone felt very full and sleepy. One by one, they made their way upstairs to their rooms to check their things for the next day. Ron and Percy were next door to Harry. He had just closed and locked his own trunk, and he heard angry voices through the wall and went to see what was going on. The door of number 12 was ajar, and Percy was shouting. It was here, on the bedside table. I took it off for polishing. I haven't touched it, all right? Ron roared back. What's up, said Harry. My head boy badge has gone, said Percy, rounding on Harry. So Scabbers rapped on it, said Ron, throwing things out of his trunk to look. I think I might have left it in the bar. You're not going anywhere till you've found my badge, yelled Percy. I'll get Scabbers' stuff. I'm packed, Harry said to Ron, and he went downstairs. Harry was halfway along the passage to the bar, which was now very dark, when he heard another pair of angry voices coming from the parlour. A second later, he recognised them as Mr. and Mrs. Weasley's. He hesitated, not wanting them to know he'd heard them rowing, when the sound of his own name made him stop, then move closer to the parlour door. Makes no sense not to tell him, Mr. Weasley was saying heatedly. Harry's got a right to know. I've tried to tell Fudge, but he insists on treating Harry like a child. He's 13 years old, and Arthur, the truth would terrify him, said Mrs. Weasley, shrilly. Do you really want to send Harry back to school with that hanging over him? For heaven's sake, he's happy not knowing. I don't want to make him miserable. I want to put him on his guard, reported Mr. Weasley. You know what Harry and Ron are like, wandering off by themselves. They've even ended up in the Forbidden Forest. But Harry mustn't do that this year. When I think what could have happened to him that night, he ran away from home, if the night bus hadn't picked him up. I'm prepared to bet he would have been dead before the ministry found him. But he's not dead. He's fine. So what's the point? Molly, they say Sirius Black's mad, and maybe he is, but he was clever enough to escape from Azkaban, and that's supposed to be impossible. It's been a month now, and no one's seen hide nor hair of him, and I don't care what Fudge keeps telling the Daily Prophet. We're no nearer catching Black than inventing self-spelling words and wands. The only thing we know for sure is what Black's after. But Harry will be perfectly safe at Hogwarts. We thought Azkaban was perfectly safe. If Black can break out of Azkaban, he can break into Hogwarts. But no one's really sure that Black's after Harry. There was a thud on wood, and Harry was sure Mr. Weasley had banged his fist on the table. Molly, how many times do I have to tell you? They didn't report it in the press because Fudge wanted it kept quiet. But Fudge went out to Azkaban the night Black escaped. The guards told Fudge that Black's been talking in his sleep for a while now. Always the same words. He's at Hogwarts. He's at Hogwarts. Black is deranged, Molly, and he wants Harry dead. If you ask me, he thinks murdering Harry will bring you-know-who back to power. Black lost everything the night Harry stopped you-know-who, and he's had 12 years alone in Azkaban to brood on that. There was a silence. Harry leant still closer to the door, desperate to hear more. Well, Arthur, you must do what you think is right. But you're forgetting Albus Dumbledore. I don't think anything could hurt Harry at Hogwarts, while Dumbledore's headmaster. I suppose he knows about all this. Of course he knows. We have to ask him if he minds the Azkaban guards stationing themselves around the entrances to the school grounds. He wasn't happy about it, but he agreed. Not happy? Why shouldn't he be happy if they're to catch Black? Dumbledore isn't fond of the Azkaban guards, said Mr. Weasley heavily. Nor am I, if it comes to that. But when you're dealing with a wizard like Black, you sometimes have to join forces with those you'd rather avoid. They save Harry. Then I will never say another word against them, said Mr. Weasley wearily. It's late, Molly. We'd better go up. Harry heard chairs move. As quietly as he could, he hurried down the passage to the bar and out of sight. The parlour door opened, and a few seconds later, footsteps told him that Mr. and Mrs. Weasley were climbing the stairs. The bottle of rat tonic was lying under the table they had sat at earlier. Harry waited until he heard Mr. and Mrs. Weasley's bedroom door close, and then headed back upstairs with the bottle. Fred and George were crouching in the shadows on the landing, heaving with laughter as they listened to Percy dismantling his and Ron's room in the search for his badge. "We've got it," Fred whispered to Harry. "We've been improving it." The badge now read, "Big Head Boy." Harry forced a laugh, went to give Ron the rat tonic, then shut himself in.
Big Head Boy.
So, Sirius Black was after him. That explained everything. Fudge had been lenient with him because he was so relieved to find him alive. He'd made Harry promise to stay in Diagon Alley, where there were plenty of wizards to keep an eye on him, and he was sending two ministry cars to take them all to the station tomorrow so that the Weasleys could look after Harry until he was on the train. Harry lay listening to the muffled shouting next door.
Big Head Boy.
He wondered why he didn't feel more scared. Sirius Black had murdered 13 people with one curse. The safest place on earth was wherever Albus Dumbledore.
How are you?
Didn't people always say that Dumbledore was the only person Lord Voldemort had ever been afraid of? Surely Black, as Voldemort's right-hand man, would be just as frightened of him. And then there were these Azkaban guards.
Shy, what you up to?
They seemed to scare most people senseless. And if they were stationed all around the school, Black's
hope you're doing well.
Very remote. No, all in all, the thing that bothered Harry most was the fact that his chances of visiting Hogsmeade now looked like zero. Nobody would want Harry to leave the safety of the castle until Black was caught. In fact, Harry suspected his every move would be carefully watched until the danger had passed. He scowled at the dark ceiling.
How is everyone tonight? Well, mostly lurkers tonight. I'm pretty sure everybody's doing their own thing right now, which is fine. I just know that they're lurkers, and that's okay. That's okay. You're invited to hang out as well. You're invited to chill out.
Tom woke Harry next morning with his usual toothless grin and a cup of tea. Harry got dressed and was just persuading a disgruntled Hedwig to get back into her.
As usual, I'm trying. Well, you're invited to chill out while you draw. You're invited to just chill out, hang out with the goat. You're invited. You're also invited in VC if you want. Just if you want. I'm not pushing you. I would love to hang out with you, but it's all good.
Who had looked in to congratulate Ron on infuriating Percy again. They headed down to breakfast, where Mr. Weasley was reading the front page of the Daily Prophet with a furrowed brow, and Mrs. Weasley was telling Hermione and Ginny about a love potion she'd made as a young girl. All three of them were rather giggly. "What were you saying?" Ron asked Harry as they sat down. "Later," Harry muttered, as Percy stormed in. Harry had no chance to speak to Ron or Hermione in the chaos of leaving. They were too busy heaving all their trunks down the leaky cauldron's narrow staircase and piling them up near the door, with Hedwig and Hermes, Percy's screech owl, perched on top of the cages. A small wickerwork basket stood beside the heap of trunks, spitting loudly.
"You're always welcome to chill out with the goat.
The wickerwork. I'll let you out on the train." "You won't," snapped Ron. "What about poor Scabbers, eh?" He pointed at his chest, where a large lump indicated that Scabbers was curled up in his pocket. Mr. Weasley, who had been outside waiting for the ministry cars, stuck his head inside. "They're here," he said. "Harry, come on." Mr. Weasley marched Harry across the short stretch of pavement towards the first of two old-fashioned dark green cars, each of which was driven by a furtive-looking wizard wearing a suit of emerald velvet. In you get, Harry, said Mr. Weasley, glancing up and down the crowded street. Harry got into the back of the car and was shortly joined by Hermione, Ron, and to Ron's disgust, Percy. The journey to King's Cross was very uneventful compared to Harry's trip on the night bus. The Ministry of Magic cars seemed almost ordinary, though Harry noticed that they could slide through gaps that Uncle Vernon's new company car certainly couldn't have managed. They reached King's Cross with 20 minutes to spare. The Ministry drivers found them trolleys and loaded their trunks, touched their hats, and immediately drove away. Somehow managing to jump to the head of an unmoving queue for the traffic lights. Mr. Weasley kept close to Harry's elbow all the way into the station. Right then, he said, as there are so many of us, I'll go through first with Harry. Mr. Weasley strolled towards the barrier between platforms 9 and 10, pushing Harry's trolley, and apparently very interested in the Intercity 125 that had just arrived at platform 9. With a meaningful look at Harry, he leant casually against the barrier. Harry imitated him. Next moment, they had fallen sideways onto platform 9 and 3/4.
There's Raven. Up to see the Hogwarts She's track, waving.
A scarlet steam engine puffing smoke over a platform packed with witches and wizards.
Hello. Hello. Also, Raven, you're invited to the call. If you are feeling up to it, you're invited to hang out with me as well.
Ginny caught Harry's eye. And they both
just in case.
To hide their laughter as Percy strode over to a girl with long curly hair, walking with his chest thrown out so that he couldn't miss it, so that she couldn't miss his shiny badge. Once the remaining Weasleys and Hermione had joined them, Harry and Mr. Weasley led the way to the end of the
head
train.
Boy.
Past packed
head boy.
That looked quite empty. They loaded the trunks onto it, stowed Hedwig and Crookshanks in the luggage rack, and then went back outside to say goodbye to Mr. and Mrs. Weasley. Mrs. Weasley kissed all her children, then Hermione, and finally Harry. He was embarrassed, but really quite pleased when she gave him an extra hug. Do take care, won't you, Harry? She said as she straightened up, her eyes oddly bright. Then she opened her enormous handbag and said, I've made you all sandwiches. Here you are, Ron. No, they're not corned beef. Fred? Where's Fred? Here you are, dear. Harry, said Mr. Weasley quietly, come over here a moment. He jerked his head towards a pillar, and Harry followed behind him. Leaving the others crowded around Mrs. Weasley, there's something I've got to tell you before we leave, said Mr. Weasley, in a tense voice. It's all right, Mr. Weasley, said Harry. I already know. You know? How could you know? I heard you and Mrs. Weasley talking last night. I couldn't help hearing, Harry added quickly. Sorry, that's not the way I'd have chosen you to find out, said Mr. Weasley, looking anxious. No, honestly, it's okay. This way you haven't broken your word to Fudge, and I know what's going on. Harry, you must be very scared. I'm not, said Harry sincerely. Really, he added, because Mr. Weasley was looking disbelieving. I'm not trying to be a hero, but seriously, Sirius Black can't be worse than Voldemort, can he? Mr. Weasley flinched at the sound of the name, but overlooked it. Harry, I knew you were, well, made of stronger stuff than Fudge seems to think, and I'm obviously pleased that you're not scared, but Arthur, called Mrs. Weasley, who was now shepherding the rest onto the train. Arthur, what are you doing? It's about to go. He's coming, Molly, said Mr. Weasley, but he turned back to Harry and kept talking in a lower and more hurried voice. Listen, I want you to give me your word. But I'll be a good boy and stay in the castle, said Harry gloomily. Not entirely, said Mr. Weasley, who looked more serious than Harry had ever seen him. Harry, swear to me, you won't go looking for Black. Harry stared. What? There was a loud whistle. Guards were walking around the train, slamming all the doors shut. Promise me, Harry, said Mr. Weasley, talking more quickly still, but whatever happened. Why would I go looking for someone I know wants to kill me, said Harry blankly. Swear to me, that whatever you might hear. Arthur, quickly, cried Mrs. Weasley. Steam was billowing from the train. It had started to move. Harry ran to the compartment
Just
door.
Just don't put your name in the goblet of fire, Harry. If
they leant out of the window and waved at Mr. and Mrs. Weasley.
Don't put your name in the goblet of fire.
From view. I need to talk to you in
Just
private,
for me.
Harry muttered to Ron and Hermione as the train picked up speed. Go away, Ginny, said Ron. Oh, that's nice, said Ginny happily, and she stalked off. Harry, Ron and Hermione set off down the corridor, looking for an empty compartment, but all were full except for the one at the very end of the train. This only had one occupant, a man sitting fast asleep next to the window. Harry, Ron and Hermione checked on the threshold, The Hogwarts Express was usually reserved for students, and they had never seen an adult there before, except for the witch who pushed the food trolley. The stranger was wearing an extremely shabby set of wizard's robes, which had been darned in several places. He looked ill and exhausted, though he seemed quite young. His light brown hair was flecked with grey. "Who do you reckon he is?" Ron hissed, as they sat down and slid the door shut, taking the seats furthest away from the window. "Professor R.J. Lupin," whispered Hermione at once. "How do you know that?" "It's on his case," replied Hermione, pointing at the luggage rack over
on
the
his case,
head,
you idiot.
Where there was a small basket case held together with a large quantity of neatly knotted string. The name Professor R.J. Lupin was stamped across one corner in peeling letters. "Wonder what he teaches," said Ron, frowning at Professor Lupin's pallid profile. "That's obvious," whispered Hermione. "There's only one vacancy, isn't there? Defense against the Dark Arts." Harry, Ron, and Hermione had already had two Defense Against the Dark Arts teachers, both of whom had only lasted 1 year. There were rumors that the job was jinxed. "Well, I hope he's up to it," said Ron doubtfully. "He looks like one good hex would finish him off, doesn't he? Anyway," he turned to Harry, "what were you going to tell us?" Harry explained all about Mr. and Mrs. Weasley's argument and the warning Mr. Weasley had just given him. When he'd finished, Ron looked thunderstruck, and Hermione had her hands over her mouth. She finally lowered them to say, "Sirius Black escaped to come after you. Oh, Harry, you'll have to be
literally
really careful.
I fucking
don't
fought a snake,
trouble,
guys."
"I don't go looking for trouble," said Harry, nettled. "Trouble usually finds me." "How
guys, I fought
Harry
a fucking snake.
Go
I'll be fine."
"He wants to kill him," said Ron shakily. They were taking the news worse than Harry had expected. Both Ron and Hermione seemed to be much more frightened at Black than he was. "No one knows how he got out of Azkaban," said Ron uncomfortably. "No one's ever done it before, and he was a top security prisoner too." "But they'll catch him, won't they?" said Hermione earnestly. "I mean, they've got all the muggles looking out for him too." "What's that noise?" said Ron suddenly. A faint, tinny sort of whistle was coming from somewhere. They looked all around the compartment. "Coming from your trunk, Harry," said Ron, standing up and reaching into the luggage rack. A moment later, he had pulled the pocket sneakerscope out from between Harry's robes. It was spinning very fast in the palm of Ron's hand and glowing brilliantly. Is that a sneakerscope?" said Hermione interestedly, standing up for a better look. "Yeah, mind you, it's a very cheap one," Ron said. "It went haywire just as I was tying it to Errol's leg and send it to Harry." "Were you doing anything untrustworthy at the time?" said Hermione shrewdly. "No. No, well, I wasn't supposed to be using Errol. You know, he's not really up to long journeys, but how else was I supposed to get Harry's present to him?"
"Spinning very best,"
Harry advised, as a sneakerscope whistled piercingly.
"Oh, also a new trailer for Sanic came out today.
Ron stuffed the sneakerscope into
I didn't watch it.
Horrible pair of Uncle Vernon's old socks, which deadened the sound, then closed the lid of the trunk on it. We could get it checked in Hogsmeade," said Ron, sitting back down. "They sell that sort of thing in Dervish and Banjis, magical instruments and stuff. Fred and George told me." "Do you know much about Hogsmeade?" asked Hermione keenly. "I've read it's the only entirely non-Muggle settlement in Britain." "Yeah, I think it is," said Ron, in an offhand sort of way. "But that's not why I want to go. I just want to get inside Honeydew." "What's that?" said Hermione. "It's this sweet shop," said Ron, a dreamy look coming over his face. "Where they've got everything. Pepper imps, they make you smoke at the mouth. And great fat choco balls, full of strawberry mousse and clotted cream, and really excellent sugar quills, which you can suck in class and just look like you're thinking what to write next. But Hogsmeade's a very interesting place, isn't it?" Hermione pressed on eagerly. "In Sites of Historical Sorcery, it says the inn was the headquarters for the 1612 Goblin Rebellion, and the Shrieking Shack..."
Oh, but that's still quite a price
and massive
for some of that.
"That make you levitate a few inches off the ground while you're sucking them," said Ron, who was plainly not listening to a word Hermione was saying. Hermione looked around at Harry. "Won't it be nice to get out of school for a bit and explore Hogsmeade?" "Expect it will," said Harry heavily. "You'll have to tell me when you found out." "What do you mean?" said Ron. "I can't go. The Dursley didn't sign my permission form, and Fudge wouldn't either." Ron looked horrified. "You're not allowed to come." "But no way. McGonagall or someone will give you permission." Harry gave a hollow laugh. "Professor McGonagall, head of Gryffindor House, was very strict. Or we can ask Fred and George. They know every secret passage out of the castle." "Ron," said Hermione sharply, "I don't think Harry should be sneaking out of school with Black on the loose." "Yeah, I suspect that's what McGonagall will say when I ask for permission, said Harry bitterly. But if we're with him, said Ron spiritedly to Hermione, Black wouldn't dare. Oh, Ron, don't talk rubbish, snapped Hermione. Black's already murdered a whole bunch of people in the middle of a crowded street. Do you really think he's going to worry about attacking Harry just because we're there? She was fumbling with the straps of Crookshank's basket as she spoke. Don't let that thing out, Ron said, but too late. Crookshanks leapt lightly from the basket, stretched, yawned, and sprang onto Ron's knees. The lump in Ron's pocket tumbled, trembled, and he shoved Crookshanks angrily away. Get out of it! Ron, don't, said Hermione angrily. Ron was about to answer back when Professor Lupin stirred. They watched him apprehensively, but he simply turned his head the other way, mouth slightly open, and slept on. The Hogwarts Express moved steadily north, and the scenery outside the window became wilder and darker while the clouds overhead thickened. People were chasing backwards and forwards past the door of their compartment. Crookshanks had now settled in an empty seat, his squashed face turned towards Ron, his yellow eyes.
Goddamn Crookshanks.
At one point, the switch with the food trolley arrived at the compartment door. Maybe you should wake him up, Ron asked awkwardly, nodding towards Professor Lupin. He looks like he could do with some food. Hermione approached Professor Lupin cautiously. Professor, she said. Excuse me, Professor. He didn't move. Don't worry, dear, said the witch, as she handed Harry a large stack of cauldron cakes. If he's hungry when he wakes, I'll be up front with the driver. I suppose he is asleep, said Ron quietly, as the witch slid the compartment door closed. I mean, he doesn't die, does he? No, no, he's breathing, whispered Hermione, taking the cauldron cake Harry passed her. He might not be very good company, but Professor Lupin's presence in their compartment had its uses. Mid-afternoon, just as it had started to rain, blurring the rolling hills outside the window, they heard footsteps in the corridor again, and their three least favourite people appeared at the door. Draco Malfoy, flanked by his cronies Vincent Crabbe and Gregory Goyle. Draco Malfoy and Harry had been enemies ever since they had met on their very first...
You know what, it would be funny to hear Malfoy, and he's just like, oh yeah, Harry Potter, he goes to my school. Aren't you two, like, mortal enemies? I don't really give a shit. I just kind of pick on him and five other people. I kind of don't even think about him. Yeah.
Seeker on the
why would I? Why would I give a shit?
The same position that Harry played on the Gryffindor team. Crabbe and Goyle seemed to exist to do Malfoy's bidding. They were both wide and muscly. Crabbe was the taller, with a pudding basin haircut and a very thick neck. Goyle had short, bristly hair and a long gorilla arms. Well, look who it is, said Malfoy in his usual lazy drawl, pulling open a compartment door. Potty and a weasel. Crabbe and Goyle chuckled foolishly. I heard your father finally got his hands on some gold this summer, Weasley, said Malfoy. Did your mother die of shock? Ron stood up so quickly, he knocked Crookshank's basket to the floor. Professor Lupin gave a snort. Who's that? Said Malfoy, taking an automatic step backwards as he spotted Lupin. New teacher, said Harry, who had got to his feet too, in case he needed to hold Ron back. What were you saying, Malfoy? Malfoy's pale eyes narrowed. He wasn't cool enough to pick a fight right under a teacher's nose. Come on, he muttered resentfully to Crabbe and Goyle, and they disappeared. Harry and Ron sat down again, Ron massaging his knuckles. I'm not going to take any rubbish from Malfoy this year, he said angrily. I mean it. If he makes one more crack about my family, I'm going to get hold of his head and... Ron made a violent gesture in midair. Ron, Mr. Hermione, pointing at Professor Lupin, be careful. But Professor Lupin was still fast asleep.
Shadow stepping.
As the train sped yet further north, the windows were now a solid, shimmering grey, which gradually darkened into...
She's shadow stepping. Watch out.
And over
watch
the
out.
Track, the rain rattled. The rain
shadow stepping.
The wind roared, but still, Professor Lupin slept. We must be nearly there, said Ron, leaning forward to look past Professor Lupin at the now completely black window. The words had hardly left him when the train started to slow down. Brilliant, said Ron, looking up and walking carefully past Professor Lupin to try and see outside. I'm starving. I want to get to the feast. We can't be there yet, said Hermione, checking her watch. So why are we stopping? The train was getting slower and slower. As the noise of the pistons fell away, the wind and rain sounded louder than ever against the windows. Harry, who was the nearest to the door, got up to look into the corridor. All along the carriage, heads were sticking curiously out of their compartments. The train came to a stop, to a jolt, and distant thuds and bangs told them that the luggage had fallen out of the rack. Then, without warning, all the lamps went out, and they were plunged into total darkness.
Boom!
Said Ron's voice from behind Harry. Ouch! Gasped Hermione. Ron, that was my foot. Harry felt his way back to his seat. You know, the thing was broken down. Dunno. There was a squeaking sound, and Harry saw the dim black outline of Ron, wiping a patch clean on the window and peering out. There's something moving out there, Ron said. I think people are coming aboard. The compartment door suddenly opened, and someone fell painfully over Harry's legs. Sorry, do you know what's going on? Ouch, sorry. Hello, Neville, said Harry, feeling around in the dark and pulling Neville up by his cloak. Harry, is that you? What's happening? No idea. Sit down. There was a loud hissing and a yelp of pain. Neville had tried to sit on Crookshanks. I'm going to go and ask the driver what's going on, came Hermione's voice. Harry felt her pass him, heard the door slide open again, and then a thud and two loud squeals of pain.
Who's
that? Ginny! No! What are you doing? I was looking for come in and sit
Don't
down.
Tell me!
Not there, said Harry.
You didn't put your name in a cover!
Said Neville. Quiet!
No, sir! No!
Suddenly, Professor Lupin.
You didn't put your name in a
Harry could hear movements in his corner. None of them spoke. There was a soft, crackling noise, and a shivering light filled the compartment. Professor Lupin appeared to be...
I used my new PNG tuber today. Nice!
Gray face.
Nice, how long did you stream?
Stay where you are,
Zara.
In the same hoarse voice, and he got slowly to his feet, with his handful of fire held out in front of him. But the door slid slowly open before Lupin could reach it. Standing in the doorway,
3 hours. Nice.
By the shivering flames in Lupin's hand, was a right. figure that towered to the ceiling. Its face was completely.
I gotta ask demonic
Harry's
what he wants.
Downward, and what he saw made
as a background.
There was a hand protruding.
See what demonic wants for background.
Grayish, slimy looking, and scabbed.
Let's see what demonic wants.
The hand was suddenly withdrawn into the folds of the black material, and then the thing beneath the hood, whatever it was, drew a long, slow, rattling breath, as though it was trying to suck something more than air from its surroundings. An intense cold swept over them all. Harry felt his own breath catch in his chest. The cold went deeper than his skin. It was inside his chest. It was inside his very heart.
Memes.
Harry's eyes rolled.
Lovely every iteration of this meme.
Cold.
Love every iteration of this meme. Oh yeah. I love this song. I have it right here. And the drummer is crazy.
He's being dragged downwards, the roaring growing louder. And then, terrified, feeding a thick white fog was swirling around him, inside him. Harry, are you all right? Someone was slapping his face. What? Harry opened his eyes. There were lanterns above him, and the floor was shaking. The Hogwarts Express was moving again, and the lights had come back on. He seemed to have slid out of his seat onto the floor. Ron and Hermione were kneeling next to him, and above them, he could see Neville and Professor Lupin watching. Harry felt very sick. When he put up his hand to push his glasses back on, he felt cold sweat on his face. Ron and Hermione heaved him back onto his seat. Are you okay? Ron asked nervously. Yeah, said Harry. looking quickly towards the door.
I loved it. Someone was like, "Oh, I love Harry Potter," and then they hear that.
That thing. Who screamed? No one screamed, said Ron, more nervously still. Harry looked around the bright compartment. Ginny and Neville looked back at him, both very pale. But I heard screaming. A loud snap made them all jump. Professor Lupin was breaking an enormous slab of chocolate into pieces. "Here," he said to Harry, handing him a particularly large piece. "Eat it. It'll help." Harry took the chocolate, but didn't eat it. What was that thing?" he asked Lupin. "A Dementor," said Lupin. He was now giving chocolate to everyone else. One of the Dementors of Azkaban. Everyone stared at him. Professor Lupin crumpled up the empty chocolate wrapper and put it in his pocket. "Eat," he repeated. "It'll help. I need to speak to the driver. Excuse me." He strolled past Harry and disappeared into the corridor. "Are you sure you're okay, Harry?" said Hermione, watching Harry anxiously. "I don't get it." "What happened?" said Harry, wiping more sweat off his face. "Well, that thing, the Dementor, stood there and looked around. I mean, I think it did. I couldn't see its face. And you, I thought you were having a fit or something," said Ron, who still looked scared. "You went sort of rigid and fell out of your seat and started twitching. And Professor Lupin stepped over you and walked towards the Dementor and pulled out his wand," said Hermione. "And he said, 'None of us is hiding Sirius Black under our cloaks. Go!' But the Dementor didn't move. So Lupin muttered something and a silvery thing shot out of his wand at it. And it turned around and sort of glided away." "It was horrible," said Neville in a higher voice than usual. "Did you feel how cold it was when it came in?" I felt weird," said Ron, shifting his shoulders uncomfortably, like I'd never be cheerful again. Ginny, who was huddled in her corner, looking nearly as bad as Harry felt, gave a small sob. Hermione went over and put a comforting arm around her. "But didn't any of you fall off your seat?" said Harry awkwardly. "No," said Ron, looking anxiously at Harry again. Ginny was shaking like mad, though Harry didn't understand. He felt weak and shivery, as though he was recovering from a bad bout of flu. He also felt the beginnings of shame. Why had he gone to pieces like that, when no one else had? Professor Lupin had come back. He paused as he entered, looked around and said with a small smile, "I haven't poisoned that chocolate, you know." Harry took a bite, and to his great surprise, felt warmth spread suddenly to the tips of his fingers and toes. "We'll be at Hogwarts in 10 minutes, said Professor Lupin. "You all right, Harry?" Harry didn't ask how Professor Lupin knew his name. "Fine," he muttered, embarrassed. They didn't talk much during the remainder of the journey. At long last, the train stopped at Hogsmeade Station, and there was a great scramble to get out. Owls hooted, cats meowed, and Neville's pet toad croaked loudly from under his hat.
I'm glad you had a wonderful stream, Zara.
"Perseus, this way!" called a familiar voice. Harry, Ron, and Hermione turned and saw the gigantic outline of Hagrid at the end of the platform, beckoning the terrified-looking new students forward and their traditional...
I wish I wasn't so tired.
"All right, you three!"
Hagrid, I hate it. I hate that I'm so tired.
I had no chance to speak to
him. I just want to get work done. I've got work to do.
Out onto a rough mud track, where at least 100 stagecoaches awaited the remaining students. Each pulled, Harry could only assume, by an invisible horse, because as they climbed inside one and shut the door, the coach set off all by itself, bumping and swaying in procession. The coach smelled faintly of mould and straw. Harry felt better since the chocolate, but still weak. Ron and Hermione kept looking at him sideways, as though frightened he might collapse again. As the carriage trundled towards a pair of magnificent, wrought iron gates, flanked with stone columns topped with winged boars, Harry saw two more towering, hooded Dementors standing guard on either side. A wave of cold sickness threatened to engulf him again. He leant back into the lumpy seat and closed his eyes until they had passed through the gate. The carriage picked up speed on the long, sloping drive up to the castle. Hermione was leaning out of the tiny window, watching the many turrets and towers draw nearer. At last, the carriage swayed to a halt, and Hermione and Ron got out. As Harry stepped down, a drawling, delighted voice sounded in his ear. "You fainted, Potter? Is Longbottom telling the truth? You actually fainted?" Malfoy elbowed past Hermione to block Harry's way up the stone steps to the castle, his face gleeful and his pale eyes glinting maliciously. "Shove off, Malfoy," said Ron, whose jaw was clenched. "Yeah. You faint as well, Weasley," said Malfoy loudly. "Is the scary old Dementor fighting you too, Weasley? Is there a problem?" said a mild voice. Professor Lupin had just got out of the next carriage. Malfoy gave Professor Lupin an insolent stare, which took in the patches on the robes and the dilapidated suitcase. With a tiny hint of sarcasm in his voice, he said, "Oh no, Professor." Then he smirked at Crabbe and Goyle and led them up the steps into the castle. Hermione prodded Ron in the back to make him hurry, and the three of them joined the crowd, swarming up the steps, through the giant oak front doors and into the cavernous entrance hall, which was lit with flaming torches and housed a magnificent marble staircase which led to the upper floors.
Hope everybody's enjoying themselves.
At the right, Harry,
thank you for coming in and chilling out with me. Thank you for being so amazing. I'm sorry I'm so sleepy tonight.
I want to see you both. Harry and Hermione turned around, surprised. Professor McGonagall, Transfiguration teacher and head of Gryffindor House, was calling over the heads of the crowd. She was a stern-looking witch. She wore her hair in a tight bun. Her sharp eyes were framed with square spectacles. Harry fought his way over to her with a feeling of foreboding.
But you've got work, though.
He must have done something wrong. There's no need to look so worried. I just want a word in my office, he told them. Move along there, Weasley.
But you got such a long time to work, though. And it's only 8 a.m.
They accompanied her across the entrance hall, up the marble staircase, and along a corridor. Once they were in her office, a small room with a large welcoming fire, Professor McGonagall motioned Harry and Hermione to sit down. She settled herself behind her desk and said abruptly, "Professor Lupin sent an owl ahead to see that you were taken ill on the train, Potter." Before Harry could reply, there was a soft knock on the door, and Madame Pomfrey, the matron, came bustling in. Harry felt himself going red in the face. It was bad enough that he passed out, or whatever he had done, without everyone making all this fuss. "I'm fine," he said. "I don't need anything." "Oh, it's you, is it?" said Madame Pomfrey, ignoring this and bending down to stare closely at him. "I suppose you've been doing something dangerous again." "It was a Dementor, Poppy," said Professor McGonagall. They exchanged a dark look, and Madame Pomfrey clucked disapprovingly. "Setting Dementors around a school," she muttered, pushing Harry's hair back and feeling his forehead. "He won't be the first one who collapses. Yes, he's all clammy. Terrible things they are, and the effect they have on people who are already delicate." "Not delicate," said Harry crossly. "Of course you're not," said Madame Pomfrey absent-mindedly, now taking his pulse. "What does he need?" said Professor McGonagall crisply. "Bed rest? Should he perhaps spend tonight in the hospital wing?" "I'm fine," said Harry, jumping up. The idea of what Draco Malfoy would say if he had to go to the hospital wing was torture. "Well, he should have some chocolate, at the very least," said Madame Pomfrey, who was now trying to peer into Harry's eyes. "I've already had some," said Harry. "Professor Lupin gave me some. He gave it to all of us." "Did he now?" said Madame Pomfrey, approvingly. "So, we've finally got a defense against the dark arts teacher who knows his remedies." "Are you sure you feel all right, Potter?" said Professor McGonagall sharply. "Yes," said Harry. "Very well.
What if somebody didn't like chocolates and they had to deal with the mentors?"
"Then we can go down to the feast together." Harry went back into the corridor with Madame Pomfrey, who left for the hospital wing, muttering to herself. He only had to wait a few minutes, and then Hermione emerged, looking very happy about something, followed by Professor McGonagall, and the three of them made their way back down the marble staircase to the Great Hall. It was a sea of pointed black hats. Each of the long house tables was lined with students, their faces glimmering by the lights of thousands of candles which were floating over the tables in mid-air. Professor Flitwick, who was a tiny little wizard with a shock of white hair, was carrying an ancient hat and a three-legged stool out of the hall. "Oh," said Hermione softly, "we've missed the sorting." New students at Hogwarts were sorted into houses by trying on the sorting hat, which shouted out the house they were best suited to: Gryffindor, Ravenclaw, Hufflepuff, or
Slytherin. She doesn't have to write it again. Ah, damn.
As quietly as possible.
Ah, damn. We missed the sorting hat again, guys. Ah, gosh dang. You know what?
The Gryffindor table.
I would love to do a Harry Potter or a Modern Magic game with people. That would be fun.
Hermione sat down on either side of Ron, who had saved them seats. "What was all that about?" he muttered to Harry. Harry started to explain in a whisper, but at that moment the headmaster stood up to speak, and he broke off. Professor Dumbledore, though very old, always gave an impression of great energy. He had several feet of long silver hair.
If we did a modern magic campaign, that's what I would want.
He was often described as the greatest wizard of the age. That wasn't
being like magic just fucking came back.
As Harry watched,
and now it's hitting everybody, and we need a school to fucking deal with this so we can start bringing it back correctly.
Welcome to another year at Hogwarts. I have a few things to say to you all, and as one of them is very serious, I think it is best to get it out of the way before you become befuddled by our excellent feast. Dumbledore cleared his throat and continued. As you will be aware, after their search of the Hogwarts Express, our school is presently playing host to some of the Dementors of Azkaban, who are here on Ministry of Magic business. He paused, and Harry remembered what Mr. Weasley had said about Dumbledore not being happy with the Dementors guarding the school. They are stationed at every entrance to the grounds, Dumbledore continued, and while they are with us, I must make it plain that nobody is to leave school without permission. Dementors are not to be fooled by tricks or disguises or even invisibility cloaks, he added blandly, and Harry and Ron glanced at each other. It is not in the nature of a Dementor to understand pleading or excuses. I therefore warn each and every one of you to give them no reason to harm you. I look to the prefect, and now our new head boy and girl, to make sure that no student...
Head boy and girl.
Percy, he was sitting a few seats along from Harry, puffed out his chest again, and stared around impressively. Dumbledore paused again. He looked very seriously around at the hall, and nobody moved or made a sound. On a happier note, he continued, I'm pleased to welcome two new teachers to our ranks this year. Firstly, Professor Lupin, who has kindly consented to fill the post of Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher. There was some scattered, rather unenthusiastic applause. Only those who were in the department of the train with Professor Lupin clapped hard, Harry among them. Professor Lupin looked particularly shabby next to all the other teachers in their best robes. Snape, Ron hissed in Harry's ear. Professor Snape, the potions master, was staring along the staff table at Professor Lupin. It was common knowledge that Snape wanted the Defense Against the Dark Arts job, but even Harry, who hated Snape, was startled at the expression twisting his thin, sallow face. It was beyond anger. It was loathing. Harry knew that expression only too well. It was the look Snape wore every time he set eyes on Harry.
Are you sure that it's loathing, or is it just contempt?
A lukewarm applause from Professor Lupin died away. Well, I am sorry to tell you that Professor Kettleburn, our Care of Magical Creatures teacher, retired at the end of last year in order to enjoy more time with his remaining limbs. However, I'm delighted to say that his place will be filled by none other than Rubius Hagrid, who has agreed to take on the teaching job in addition to his gamekeeping duties. Harry, Ron, Hermione stared at each other, stunned. Then they joined in with the applause, which was tumultuous, at the Gryffindor table in particular. Harry leant forward to see Hagrid, who was ruby red in the face and staring down at his enormous hands, his wide grin hidden in the tangle of his black beard. We should have known, Ron roared, pounding the table. Who else would have set us a biting book? Harry, Ron, and Hermione were the last to stop clapping. As Professor Dumbledore started speaking again, they saw that Hagrid was wiping his eyes on the tablecloth. Well, I think that's everything of importance, said Dumbledore. Let the feast begin! The golden plates and goblets before them filled suddenly with food and drink. Harry, suddenly ravenous, helped himself to everything he could reach and began to eat. It was a delicious feast. The hall echoed with talk, laughter, and the clatter of knives and forks. Harry, Ron, and Hermione, however, were eager for it to finish so that they could talk to Hagrid. They knew how much being a teacher would mean to him. Hagrid wasn't a fully qualified wizard. He had been expelled from Hogwarts in his third year for a crime he had not committed. It had been Harry, Ron, and Hermione who had cleared Hagrid's name last year. At long last, when the last morsels of pumpkin tart had melted from the golden platters, Dumbledore gave the word that it was time for them all to go to bed, and they got their chance. Congratulations, Hagrid.
Also, where's his horrible fucking song that he makes everybody sing? No. Please. Please, I want to hear the horrible fucking song that he seems to make everybody fucking sing.
Overcome with emotion, he buried his face in his napkin, and Professor McGonagall shooed them away. Harry, Ron, and Hermione joined the
Gryffindors. Did you forget that? That was a character trait. It was a character trait from Dumbledore. And then she gets rid of it next book. Because nobody remembered it.
Coming through. Percy called from behind the crowd. The new passwords, Fortuna Major. Oh no, said Neville Longbottom sadly. He always had trouble remembering the password. Through the portrait hole and across the common room, the girls and boys divided towards their separate staircases. Harry climbed the spiral stairs with no thought in his head except how glad he was to be back. They reached their familiar circular dormitory and its
headed empty. Must get Gryffindor passwords.
When Harry, Ron, and Hermione entered the Great Hall for breakfast next day. The first thing they saw was Draco Malfoy.
Head thick with Gryffindor passwords.
A very funny story. As they passed, Malfoy did a ridiculous impression of a swooning fit, and there was a roar of laughter. Ignore him, said Hermione. He was right behind Harry. Just ignore him. It's not worth it. Hey, Potter, shrieked Pansy Parkinson, a slithering girl with a face like a pug. Potter, the Dementors are coming. Potter, woo! Harry dropped into a seat at the Gryffindor table next to George Weasley. New third-year timetable, said George, passing them over. What's up with you, Harry? Malfoy, said Ron, sitting down on George's other side and glaring over at the Slytherin table. George looked up in time to see Malfoy pretending to faint with terror again. That little git, he said calmly. He wasn't so cocky last night when the Dementors were down our end of the train. Came running into our compartment, didn't he, Fred? Nearly wet himself, said Fred, with a contemptuous glance at Malfoy. Wasn't too happy myself, said George. They're horrible things, those Dementors. Sort of freeze your insides, don't they, said Fred. No, you didn't pass out, though, did you, said Harry in a low voice. Forget it, Harry, said George bracingly. Dad had to go out to Azkaban one time. Remember, Fred? And he said it was the worst place he'd ever been. He came back all weak and shaking. They suck the happiness out of a place, Dementors. Most of the prisoners go mad in there. Anyway, we'll see how happy Malfoy looks after our first Quidditch match, said Fred. Gryffindor versus Slytherin. First game of the season, remember? The only time Harry and Malfoy had faced each other in a Quidditch match, Malfoy had definitely come off worse. Feeling slightly more cheerful, Harry helped himself to sausages and fried tomatoes. Hermione was examining her new timetable. Ooh, good. We're starting with new subjects today, she said happily. Hermione, said Ron, frowning as he looked over her shoulder. They messed up your timetable, look. They've got you down for about 10 subjects a day. There isn't enough time. I'll manage. I fixed it all with Professor McGonagall. But look, said Ron, laughing. See, this morning, 9 o'clock, divination. And underneath, 9 o'clock, muggle studies. And Ron leant closer to the timetable, disbelieving. Look, underneath that, arithmetic. 9 o'clock. I mean, I know you're good, Hermione, but no one's that good. How are you supposed to be in 3 classes at once? Don't be silly, said Hermione shortly. Of course I won't be in 3 classes at once. Well then, pass the marmalade. Well,
technically, but you will be in 3 classes at once. And also, you need to make sure that you don't meet your past selves and stop you from existing.
He was wearing a long moleskin overcoat and was absent-mindedly.
You should watch out for non-existence.
Enormous hand.
All right. That's the most difficult part. That's the one you gotta watch out for. That's what you gotta watch out for, guys.
He said eagerly, pausing on the way to the staff table.
During my first ever lesson,
right after lunch. Five, getting everything ready. Hope it's okay. Me, a teacher, honestly.
So glad to be.
And headed off to the staff table, still swinging the pole cap. Wonder what he's been getting ready, said Ron, a note of anxiety in his voice. The hall was starting to empty as people headed off towards their first lesson. Ron checked his timetable. We'd better go look, divination's at the top of North Tower. It'll take about 10 minutes to get there. They finished their breakfast hastily, said goodbye to Fred and George, and walked back through the hall. As they passed the Slytherin table, Malfoy did yet another impression of a fainting fit. The shouts of laughter followed Harry into the entrance hall. The journey through the castle to North Tower was a long one. 2 years at Hogwarts hadn't taught them everything about the castle, and they had never been inside North Tower before. "There's got to be a shortcut," Ron panted, as they climbed their seventh long staircase and emerged on an unfamiliar landing where there was nothing but a large painting of a bare stretch of grass hanging on the stone wall. "I think it's this way," said Hermione, peering down the empty passage to the right. "Can't be," said Ron. "That's south. Look, you can see a bit of the lake out of the window." Harry was watching the painting. A fat, dapple grey pony had just ambled onto the grass and was grazing nonchalantly. Harry was used to the subject of Hogwarts paintings, moving around and leaving their frames to visit each other, but he always enjoyed watching them. A moment later, a short, squat knight in a suit of armour had clanked into the picture after his pony. By the look of the grass stains on his metal knees, he had just fallen off. "Aha!" he yelled, seeing Harry, Ron and Hermione. "What villains are these that trespass upon my private lands? Come to spawn at my fall, perchance? Roar your names, you dogs!" They watched in astonishment as the little knight tugged his sword out of its scabbard and began brandishing it violently, hopping up and down in rage. But the sword was too long for him. A particularly wild swing made him overbalance, and he landed face down in the grass. "You all right?" said Harry, moving closer to the picture. "Get back, you scurvy braggart! Back, you rogue!" The knight seized his sword again and used it to push himself back up. But the blade sank deeply into the grass, and though he pulled with all his might, he couldn't get it out again. Finally, he had to flop back down onto the grass and push up his visor to mop his sweating face. "Listen," said Harry, taking advantage of the knight's exhaustion. "You're looking for the North Tower. You don't know where the way to go, do you?" "A quest!" The knight's rage seemed to vanish instantly. He clanked to his feet and shouted, "Come follow me, dear friends, and we shall find our goal, or else shall perish bravely in the charge." He gave the sword another fruitless tug, tried and failed to mount the fat pony, and cried, "On foot, then. Good sirs and gentle lady, on, on!" And he ran, clanking loudly, into the left-hand side of the frame and out of sight. They hurried after him along the corridor, following the sound of the armour. Every now and then they spotted him running through a picture ahead. "Be of stout heart, the worst is yet to come," yelled the knight, and they saw him reappear in front of an alarmed group of women in crinolines, whose picture hung on the wall of a narrow spiral staircase. Puffing loudly, Harry, Ron and Hermione climbed the tightly spiraled steps, getting dizzier and dizzier, until at last they heard the murmur of voices above them, and knew they had reached the classroom. "Farewell," cried the knight, popping his head into a painting of some sinister-looking monks. "Farewell, my comrades in arms. If ever you have need of a noble heart and steely sinew, call upon Sir Cadogan."
"Yeah, yep.
We'll call you," muttered Ron, as the knight disappeared. "If we ever need someone mental..." They climbed the last few steps and emerged onto a tiny landing where most of the class had already assembled. There were no doors of this landing. Ron nudged Harry and pointed at the ceiling, where there was a circular trapdoor with a brass plaque on it. "Sybil Trelawney, divination teacher," Harry said. "How are we supposed to get up there?" As though the answer to his question, the trapdoor suddenly opened and a silvery ladder descended right at Harry's feet. Everyone went quiet. "After you," said Ron, grinning. So Harry climbed the ladder first. He emerged into the strangest-looking classroom he'd ever seen. In fact, it didn't look like a classroom at all, more like a cross between someone's attic and an old-fashioned tea shop. At least 20 small circular tables were crammed inside it, all surrounded by chintz armchairs and fat little poofs. Everything was lit with a dim, crimson light. The curtains of the windows were all closed, and the many lamps were draped with dark red scarves. It was stiflingly warm. And the fire, which was burning under the crowded mantelpiece...
Well, I'm gonna go for 3 hours, and then I'm gonna call it a night.
Running around the circular wall,
I'm tired with dust and sleepy. I want bed.
Many packs of tattered playing cards, countless silvery crystal balls, and a huge array of teacups. Ron appeared at
Makes me feel better whenever I put a time limit on there.
Talking in whispers. "Where is she?" Ron said. A voice came suddenly out of the shadows. A soft,
one more hour.
Voice. "Welcome," it said. "How nice to see you all in the physical world at last." Harry's immediate impression was of a large, glittering insect. Professor Trelawney moved into the firelight, and they saw that she was very thin, her large glasses magnifying her eyes to several times their natural size. And she
the
was
almighty bed.
Innumerable
it's so nice. And I'm going to get up early tomorrow so that I can call up the local Chinese place. I'm going to get Chinese for lunch and dinner.
Welcome to divination, said Professor Trelawney, who had seated herself in a winged armchair in front of the fire. My name is Professor Trelawney. You may not have seen me before. I find that descending too often into the hustle and bustle of the main school clouds my inner eye. Nobody said anything in answer to this extraordinary pronouncement. Professor Trelawney delicately rearranged her shawl and continued, so you have chosen to study divination, the most difficult of all magical arts. I must warn you at the outset that if you do not have the sight, there is very little I will be able to teach you.
I saw YMS's review of the Matrix movie, and he's like, it's garbage, and he doesn't want to just dismiss movies and stuff like that, and he's like, eh, you know, I would get on everybody's bandwagon and stuff like that, but there are people out there that say that it's really good, and he doesn't get why, and he explained his reasoning, and I'm like, yeah, makes sense. Yep, I agree with you. Just, but here's the thing, I agree with him, and I'm falling into the trope that I hate when other people do, where they just listen to an expert, and then they're like, oh yes, I know everything about this subject. I don't need a second opinion. I already know. I trust them completely. It's like, okay, well, what if they're wrong? What if this time they're wrong? It's like that's my biggest thing. Even if you really like the person that you're following or anything like that, you should make sure that you're making the right decision. And I'm like,
a very tense silence followed this.
I'm probably gonna have to watch it just to make sure that he's not wrong about it.
He was nearest and shrank back in her chair. If you could pass me the largest silver teapot. Lavender, looking relieved, stood up, took an enormous teapot from the shelf, and put it down on the table in front of Professor Trelawney. Thank you, my dear. Incidentally, that thing you are dreading, it will happen on Friday, the 16th of October. Lavender trembled. Now, I want you all to divide into pairs, collect a teacup from the shelf, come to me and I will fill it. Then sit down and drink. Drink until only the dregs remain. Swirl these around the cup 3 times with the left hand. Then turn the cup upside down on its saucer and wait for the last of the tea to drain away. Then give your cup to your partner to read. You will interpret the patterns using pages 5 and 6 of Unfogging the Future. I shall move among you, helping and instructing. Oh, and dear, she caught Neville by the arm as he made to stand up. After you've broken your first cup, would you be so kind as to select one of the blue patterned ones? I'm rather attached to the pink. Sure enough, Neville had no sooner reached the shelf of teacups than there was a tinkle of breaking china. Professor Trelawney swept over to him holding a dustpan and brush and said, one of the blue ones then, dear, if you wouldn't mind. Thank you. When Harry and Ron had their teacups filled, they went back to their table and tried to drink the scalding tea quickly. They swirled the dregs around, as Professor Trelawney had instructed, then drained the cups and swapped them. Right, said Ron, as they both opened their books at pages 5 and 6. What can you see in mine? A load of soggy brown stuff, said Harry. The heavily perfumed smoke in the room was making him feel sleepy and stupid. Broaden your minds, my dears, and allow your eyes to see past the mundane, Professor Trelawney cried through the gloom. Harry tried to pull himself together. Right, you've got a wonky sort of cross, he said, consulting Unfogging the Future. That means you're going to have trials and suffering. Sorry about that, but there's a thing that could be the sun. Hang on, that means great happiness. So you're going to suffer, but be very happy. You need your inner eye testing, if you ask me, said Ron, and they both had to stifle their laughs as Professor Trelawney gazed in their direction. My turn. Ron peered into Harry's teacup, his forehead wrinkled with effort. There's a blob, a bit like a bowler hat, he said. Maybe you're going to work for the Ministry of Magic? He turned the teacup the other way up. But this way, it looks like an acorn. What's that? He scanned the copy of Unfogging the Future. A windfall. Unexpected gold. Excellent, you can lend me some. And there's a thing here. He turned the cup again. Looks like an animal. Yeah, if that was its head. Looks like a hippo. No, a sheep. Professor Trelawney whirled around as Harry let out a sort of laughter. Let me see that, my dear, she said reprovingly to Ron, sweeping over and snatching Harry's cup from him. Everyone went quiet to watch. Professor Trelawney was staring into the teacup.
And then the galactic bee have to do the background stuff.
But everyone knows that, said Hermione, in a loud whisper. Professor Trelawney stared at her. Well, they do, said Hermione. Everybody knows about Harry and you-know-who. Harry and Ron stared at her with a mixture of amazement and admiration. They'd never heard Hermione speak to a teacher like that before. Professor Trelawney chose not to reply. She lowered her huge eyes to Harry's cup again and continued to turn it. The club. An attack. Dear, this is not a happy cup. I thought that was a bowler hat, said Ron sheepishly. The skull. Danger in your path, my dear. Everyone was staring.
Almighty bed. I know. I need the almighty bed. If only I... If only they'd let me sleep. If only they'd let me sleep,
Bee,
why won't they let me sleep? I don't know why I'm so sleepy tonight. I'm very, very tired. I think it's because I have no fucking caffeine. All I have is my juice.
To get a good look at Harry's cup. My dear, Professor Trelawney's huge eyes opened dramatically.
And it ain't doing much.
The what, said Harry? He could tell that he...
I know, I do deserve sleep. I do deserve sleep, thank you.
But nearly everybody else clapped their hands to their mouths in horror. The Grim, my dear, the Grim, cried Professor Trelawney. He looked shocked that Harry hadn't understood. But the giant spectral dog that haunts churchyards, my dear boy.
What I'm saying is true. Bee race, I've had it. Only young Ganabees are able to fly, but once they grow older and gather body mass, their wings can only support short gliding, like Knuckles. Still pretty good. Gliding is still pretty good.
I drew circles, you drew times you and I.
I was thinking of the week, and I think of this song. Gliding is great, but the snowfall, slowfall spell exists, so great early on in life, yeah. Just saying. Just gotta glorify the week. You know what the game this soundtrack is from? Come on, come on, Elon. You know what this is from? Come on, Eileen. Oh, yeah, I know this song. No idea where it's from. Oh, it's from Quarantine. The game called Quarantine. They're all Australian bands. It's a futuristic hover taxis. Yeah. It's a weird game. I mean, you could probably find it and play it for free. It's abandonware, so. And then there's all of Frankie Pixel Show also plays songs like this as well. But he actually finds real bands that are like this. I find this from video games. Like all my music I always find from video games. Found a game recently called Cloudpunk. It's Cyberpunk 2077. If you were a delivery driver. Oh. Is it on Steam? Let's see.
Shake it crazy,
Issue Road is a dead end. The lights out in the cool night sky. We're coming up to the deathbed.
Oh, yeah. This is exactly what I was thinking of. Oh, it looks a pain in the ass if there ever was one. I like that they didn't make like full fucking models for the character models. Because that's fine. Like, no one is like that bothered by like, oh man, add to wish list. Oh, Ghost Runner is also a game they've made? Huh. So they made Ghost Runner. Okay. Ooh, I love that. Oh, it looks so good. Looks good. Yeah, the simple one. Yeah, it's fine. Yeah, like it's just fine when they have things like that. Like, that's my biggest thing. It's like, I don't need a full fucking models. If it works and is better than the regular, unlike Cyberpunk, which had shader bug where a wave of light shading would turn everyone's skin color dark if they walked into it. Oh, damn. Man, I remember people were talking about that game so much. I was like, it's... Oh, man. I hope that doesn't happen to...
I think it looks like a grin, she said flatly. Professor Trelawney surveyed Hermione with mounting dislike. You'll forgive me for saying so, my dear, but I perceive very little aura around you, very little receptivity to the resonances of the future.
What is it? What is that game? Like, I...
Seamus Finnegan.
I forgot what I was talking about completely.
It looks like a grin.
I'm dumb.
He said, with his eyes on
moving
the
on.
It looks more like a donkey from here, he said, leaning to the left. When you've all finished deciding whether I'm going to die or not, said Harry, taking even himself by surprise. Now nobody seemed to want to look at him. I think we will have the lesson here for today. We'll leave it here for today, said Professor Trelawney in her mistiest voice. Yes, please pack away your things. Silently, the class took their teacups back to Professor Trelawney, packed away their books and closed their bags. Even Ron was avoiding Harry's eyes. Until we meet again, said Professor Trelawney faintly. Fair fortunes by yours. Oh, and dear, she pointed at Neville, you'll be late next time, so mind your work extra hard to catch up. Harry, Ron, and Hermione descended Professor Trelawney's ladder and the winding staircase in silence, then set off for Professor McGonagall's transfiguration lesson. It took them so long to find her classroom that early as they had left divination, they were only just in time. Harry chose a seat right at the back of the room, feeling as though he was sitting in a very bright spotlight. The rest of the class kept shooting furtive glances at him, as though he was about to drop dead at any moment. He hardly heard what Professor McGonagall was telling them about animagi wizards who could transform at will into animals, and wasn't even watching when she transformed herself in front of their eyes into a tabby cat and respectable markings around her eyes. Really, what has got into you all today, said Professor McGonagall, turning back into herself with a faint pop and staring around at them all. Not that it matters, but that's the first time any transformation's not got a pause from a class. Everybody's heads turned towards Harry again, but nobody spoke. Then Hermione raised her hand. Please, Professor, we've just had our first divination class, and we were reading the tea leaves and... Ah, of course, said Professor McGonagall, suddenly frowning. There is no need to say any more, Miss Granger. Tell me, which of you will be dying this year? Everyone stared at her. Me, said Harry finally. I see, said Professor McGonagall, fixing Harry with her beady eyes. Then you should know, Potter, that Sybil Trelawney has predicted the death of one student a year since she arrived at this school. None of them has died yet. Seeing deaf omens is her favourite way of getting a new, meeting a new class, if it were not for the fact that I never speak ill of my colleagues. Professor McGonagall broke off, and they saw that her nostrils had gone white. She went on more calmly. Divination is one of the most imprecise branches of magic. I shall not conceal from you that I have very little patience with it. True seers are very rare, and Professor Trelawney. She stopped again, and then said in a very matter-of-fact tone, you look in excellent health to me, Potter, so you will excuse me if I don't let you off homework today. I assure you that if you die, you need not hand it in. Hermione laughed. Harry felt a bit better. It was harder to feel scared of a lump of tea leaves away from the dim red light and befuddling perfume of Professor Trelawney's classroom. Not everyone was convinced, however. Ron still looked worried, and Lavender whispered, but what about Neville's cup? When the Transfiguration class had finished, they joined the crowd thundering towards the Great Hall for lunch. Ron, cheer up, said Hermione, pushing a dish of stew towards him. You heard what Professor McGonagall said. Ron spooned stew onto his plate and picked up his fork, but didn't start. Harry, he said, in a low, serious voice, you haven't seen a great black dog anywhere, have you?
Yes, yeah, we have.
I have, said Harry. I saw one the night I left the Dursleys. Ron let his fork fall with a clatter. Probably a stray, said Hermione calmly. Ron looked at Hermione as though she had gone mad. Hermione, if Harry's seen a grim, that's bad, he said. My uncle Bilious saw one and he died 24 hours later. Coincidence, said Hermione airily, pouring herself some pumpkin juice.
Yeah.
You don't know what you're talking about.
Love going to school and the teacher telling us all, one of us will die this year. Good luck, everyone!
In a superior tone. They see the Grim and die of fright. The Grim is not an omen, it's the cause of death. And Harry's still with us because he's not stupid enough to see one and think, right, well, I'd better pop my clogs then. Ron mouthed wordlessly at Hermione, who opened her bag, took out her new arithmetic book, and popped it up against the juice jug. I think divination seems very woolly, she said, searching to her page. A lot of guesswork, if you ask me. There was nothing really woolly about the Grim in that cup, said Ron hotly. You didn't seem quite so confident when you were calling it a sheep, said Hermione coolly. Professor Trelawney said you didn't have the right aura. You just don't like being rubbish at something for a change. He had touched a nerve. Hermione slammed her arithmetic book down on the table so hard that bits of meat and carrot flew everywhere. If being good at divination means I have to pretend to see death omens in a lump of tea leaves, I'm not sure I'll be studying it much longer. That lesson was absolutely rubbish compared to my arithmetic class. She snatched up her bag and stalked away. Ron frowned after her. What's she talking about? He said to Harry. She hasn't been to an arithmetic class yet. Harry was pleased to get out of the castle after lunch. Yesterday's rain had cleared. The sky was a clear pale grey, and the grass was springy and damp underfoot as they set off for their first ever pair of magical creatures class. Ron and Hermione weren't speaking to each other. Harry walked beside them in silence as they went down the sloping lawns to Hagrid's hut on the edge of the Forbidden Forest. It was only when he spotted three only too familiar backs of heads, familiar backs ahead of them, that he realised that must be it, having those lessons with the Slytherins. Malfoy was talking animatedly to Crabbe and Goyle, who were chortling. Harry was quite sure he knew what they were talking about. Hagrid was waiting for his class at the door at his hut. He stood in his moleskin overcoat, with Fang, the boarhound, at his heels, looking impatient to start. Come on now, get a move on, he called, as the class approached. Got a real treat for you today. Great lesson coming up. Everyone here? Right, follow me. For one nasty moment, Harry thought that Hagrid was going to lead them into the forest. Harry had had enough unpleasant experiences there to last him a lifetime. However, Hagrid strolled off around the edge of the trees, and 5 minutes later they found themselves outside a kind of paddock. There was nothing in there. Everyone gather round the fence here, he yelled. That's it, make sure you can see. Now, first thing you'll want to do is open your book. How? Said the cold, drooling sound of Draco Malfoy. Hey, said Hagrid. How do we open our book? Malfoy repeated. He took out his copy of the Monster Book of Monsters, which had been bound shut with a length of rope. Other people took theirs out too. Some, like Harry, had belted their book shut. Others had crammed them inside tight bags or clamped them together with bull clips. Hasn't anyone been able to open their books? Said Hagrid, looking crestfallen. The class all shook their heads. Now you gotta stroke 'em, said Hagrid, as though this was the most obvious thing in the world. Look, He took Hermione's copy and ripped off the speller tape that bound it. The book tried to bite, but Hagrid ran a giant forefinger down its spine, and the book shivered and then fell open and lay quiet on his hand. "Oh, how silly we've all been," Malfoy sneered. "We should have stroked them. Why didn't we guess?" I thought they were funny," Hagrid said uncertainly to Hermione. "Oh, tremendously funny," said Malfoy. "Really witty, giving us books that try and rip your hands off." "Shut up, Malfoy," said Harry quietly. Hagrid was looking downcast, and Harry wanted Hagrid's first lesson to be a success. "Right then," said Hagrid. "You seem to have lost your thread. So, you've got your books, and now, yeah. You need to the magical creatures, yeah. So, I'll go and get them. Hang on." He strode away from them into the forest and out of sight. "God, this
poor Hagrid.
The dog," said Malfoy loudly. "That oaf teaching classes. My father will have a fit when I tell him." "Shut up, Malfoy," Harry repeated. "Careful, Potter. There's a Dementor behind you." "Ooh," squealed Lavender Brown, pointing towards the opposite side of the paddock. Trotting towards them were a dozen of the most bizarre creatures Harry had ever seen. They had the bodies, hind legs and tails of horses, but the front legs, wings and heads of what seemed to be giant eagles, with cruel steel-coloured beaks and large, brilliantly orange eyes. The talons on their front legs were half a foot long and deadly-looking. Each of the beasts had a thick leather collar around its neck, which was attached to a long chain, and the ends of all of these were held in the vast hands of Hagrid, who came jogging into the paddock behind the creatures. "Get up there!" he roared, shaking the chains and urging the creatures towards the fence where the class stood. Everyone drew back slightly as Hagrid reached them and tethered the creatures onto the fence. "Hippogriffs!" Hagrid roared happily, waving a hand at them. "Beautiful, aren't they?" Harry could sort of see what Hagrid meant. Once he had got over the first shock of seeing something that was half horse, half bird, he started to appreciate the hippogriffs. Gleaming coats, changing smoothly from feather to hair, each of them a different colour, stormy grey, bronze, a pinkish roan, gleaming chestnut and inky black.
"Do I hear Harry Potter?"
Rubbing his hands together and beaming around.
"You put an A in there!"
No one cared.
"Where did you put an A?"
Harry, Ron and Hermione.
"Did you put an A in there?"
"Now, first thing you gotta know about hippogriffs is they're proud," said Hagrid.
"Did you watch an Iron Man?"
"Hippogriffs are."
Yes, you were listening to Harry Potter. We're on Prisoner of Azkaban. Hello. Hello, Swordberries. Yes, yes.
Yeah. Walk towards it.
Thank you so much for coming in. Thank you, one.
And you wait.
You wonderful person.
Back, you're allowed to touch him. If he doesn't bow, then get away from him, sharpish. Those talons hurt.
Oh!
Right. Who wants to go first?
Oh, Swordberries! Thank you! Answer, thank you so much!
Berries and cream. Berries and cream. I'm a little lad who likes berries and cream.
No one.
Thank you so much, Swordberries. Do you like? Are you a fan of art?
Behind him.
Are you a fan of Harry Potter? Are you a fan of both?
Remember your tea leaves. Harry ignored them. He climbed over the paddock fence. Good man, Harry. Roared Hagrid. Right then. Let's see how you get on.
Splatoon player.
Pulled the grey hippogriff away from the fellows and lifted it and slipped off his leather collar. The class on the other side of the paddock seemed to be holding its breath. Malfoy's eyes were narrowed maliciously. Easy now, Harry, said Hagrid quietly.
Oh, you're a university.
You've got eye contact. Now,
keeping me occupied. All right. 20 years old.
Harry's eyes immediately began to water.
Ah! I like art. I saw your stream by searching for Giftuber. Nice. Hell yeah.
That's it, said Hagrid.
Galactic BC, people are looking at me. They notice me.
But he did as he was told.
They're noticing me.
And then looked up. The hippogriff was still staring haughtily at him. It didn't move. Ah, said Hagrid, sounding worried. Right. Back
nice.
Away now. Harry easy does it.
Yeah, oh. Harry's yeah, we have that. Body. We have the this sound on there.
Bent his front knees and sank into what was an unmistakable bow.
We got it down there. Harry, don't you worry.
Said Hagrid, ecstatic. Right. You can touch it.
Let's see.
Pat his beak. Go on. Feeling
where is
that
it?
A better
is
reward it? Would have been to back away. Harry moved slowly towards the hippogriff and reached out towards him.
Yeah.
He patted
here
his
it is.
Several times, and the hippogriff closed his eyes lazily, as though enjoying it. No. The class broke into applause, all except for Malfoy, Crabbe, and Goyle.
I was gonna play this one.
Right then, Harry, said Hagrid. I reckon he might let you ride him.
Burn
this
up.
Was more than Harry had bargained for. He was used to a broomstick, but he wasn't sure a hippogriff would be quite the same. You climb up there, just behind the
window. Who knew this?
Said Hagrid.
And I notice you, Well, you know what?
Harry puts
I notice you too.
Wing and hoisted himself
there.
His back. Buckbeak stood up.
Oh, my God, I love
Harry
that.
Wasn't sure where to
what the word is that?
Lord Hagrid, slapping the hippogriff's hind
quarters. Burn up.
Warning,
it's from Eric Andre show.
On either side of Harry.
It's the Eric Andre show.
Soaring upwards. It was nothing like a broomstick. And Harry knew which one he preferred. The hippogriff's wings were beating uncomfortably on either side of him, catching him under his legs and making him feel he was about to be thrown off. The glossy feathers slipped under his fingers, and he didn't dare get a stronger grip. Instead of the smooth action of the Nimbus 2000, he now felt himself rocking backwards and forwards as the hindquarters of the hippogriff rose and fell with his wings. Buckbeak flew him once around the paddock and then headed back to the ground. This was the bit Harry had been dreading. He leant back as the smooth neck lowered, feeling he was going to slip off over the beak. Then he felt a heavy thud as the four ill-assorted feet hit the ground and just managed to hold on and push himself straight again. Good work, Harry, roared Hagrid, as everyone except Malfoy, Crabbe, and Goyle cheered. Okay, who else wants a go?
Who else wants a go?
Success. The rest of
now
the
I gotta get back to work.
Into the paddock.
Love Buckbeak.
One by one.
As he even said before, she said that she's like, the animals are the best part of Harry Potter. If only there were more animals.
While Harry watched, Malfoy, Crabbe, and Goyle had taken over Buckbeak. He was bowed to Malfoy, who was now patting his beak, looking disdainful. This is very easy, Malfoy drawled, loud enough for Harry to hear him. I knew it must have been, if Potter could do it. I bet you're not dangerous at all, are you? He said to the hippogriff. Are you, you ugly great brute? It happened in a flash of steely talons. Malfoy let out a high-pitched scream, and next moment Hagrid was wrestling Buckbeak back into his collar as he strained to get at Malfoy, who lay curled in the grass, blood blossoming over his robes. I'm dying! Malfoy yelled as the class panicked. I'm dying! Look at me! It's killed me! You're not dying, said Hagrid, who had gone from very white. Someone help me! Gotta get him out of here! Hermione ran to open the gate, while Hagrid lifted Malfoy easily. As they passed, Harry saw that there was a long, deep gash in Malfoy's arm. Blood splattered the grass, and Hagrid ran with him.
That's true. Time to get into Fantastic Beasts or some
creatures.
Yay!
The Slytherins were all shouting about Hagrid.
So what kind of art do you do? By the way, Sword Barris? It said your description said that you do art. What kind of art do you do? I'm doing a commission for Galactic B, but what kind of art do you do? We love artists of all kinds. We are an art community that loves to hear about them.
Of course he will. Madame Pomfrey can mend cuts in about a second, said Harry, who had had far worse injuries mended magically by the matron. That was a really bad thing to happen in Hagrid's first class, though, wasn't it? Said Ron, looking worried. Trust Malfoy to mess things up for him. They were among the
cartoons mostly, but I've been doing Splatoon lately because I play a lot of Splatoon.
Said Hermione anxiously.
You play Splatoon? No way!
Said Ron. Harry was watching.
I can't do the voice.
A large group, including Crabbe and Goyle, were huddled together, deep in conversation. Harry was sure they were kissing.
So you
how Malfoy had got injured.
Shocker.
Well, if you can't say it wasn't an interesting first day back, can you? Said Ron gloomily. They went up to the crowded Gryffindor common room after dinner and tried to do the homework.
You're gonna do fantastic over here at Swordberries. You're gonna do wonderful over here. That dry wit will get you everywhere on this channel. If our channel isn't nothing else, it's wholesomeness and dry wit.
They put their things away and headed out. Glad to meet anybody on their glad not to meet anybody.
I love that fucking the fucking vine.
They were supposed to be out. The grass.
Where is it? Where is it?
The wolf in Mouse Clothing.
Ah!
The mouse's ghostly howl takes flame.
Ah! Ah!
Ah! It's the final one that gets you. She's a wolf in Mouse Clothing. Ah!
Was still wet and looked almost black in the twilight. When they reached Hagrid's hut, they a voice growled, "Men!" Hagrid was sitting in his shirt sleeves at his scrubbed wooden table. His forehand fang had his head in Hagrid's lap. One look told them that Hagrid had been drinking a lot. There was a pewter tankard almost as big as a bucket in front of him, and he seemed to be having difficulty in getting them into focus. "Expect it's a record," he said thickly when he recognized them. "Don't reckon they've ever had a teacher who only lasted a day before." "You haven't been sacked, Hagrid?" gasped Hermione. "Not yet," said Hagrid miserably, taking a huge gulp of whatever was in, ever was in the tankard. "It's only a matter of time, isn't it, after Malfoy?" "How is he?" said Ron, as they all sat down. "It wasn't serious, was it?" "Madame Pomfrey fixed him best she could," said Hagrid, dully. "But he's saying it's still agony, covered in bandages, moaning." "He's faking it," said Harry at once. "Madame Pomfrey can mend anything. She regrew half my bones last year. Trust Malfoy to milk it for all its worth."
Your art is really, really goaded.
"Of course," said Hagrid.
"Oh, okay. I guess my art is goaded. Okay. All right. Later. All right, guys. I guess my art is goaded now. I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry."
"We're witnesses," said Harry. "You said hippogriffs attack if you insult them. Malfoy's problem, he wasn't listening.
Don't
tell Dumbledore what really happened." "Yeah, don't worry, Hagrid.
That gets my goat or something, I guess."
Hagrid's beetle black eyes. He grabbed both Harry and Ron.
I guess I'm done for, guys.
"I don't think
dream's over. I just got goaded.
Drink, Hagrid," said
Hermione. "I was just goaded right there.
And went outside.
Just bam.
Maybe
look at that
right,
bacon
Hagrid,
sizzle."
Letting go of Harry and Ron, who both staggered away, rubbing their ribs. Hagrid heaved himself out of his chair and followed Hermione unsteadily outside. They heard a loud splash. "What's he done?" said Harry nervously, as Hermione came back in with the empty tankard. "Stuck his head in the water barrel," said Hermione, putting the tankard away. Hagrid came back, his long hair and beard sopping wet, wiping the water out of his eyes. "That's better," he said, shaking his head like a dog and drenching them all. "Listen, it was good old year. Good of you to come and see me, really." Hagrid stopped dead, staring at Harry as though he'd only just realized he was there. "What do you think you're doing, eh?" he roared so suddenly that they jumped a foot in the air. "You're not to go wandering around after dark, Harry? And you too, letting him." Hagrid strode over to Harry, grabbed his arm and pulled him to the door. "Come on," Hagrid said angrily. "I'm taking you all back up to school. Don't let me catch you walking down here to see me after dark again. I'm not worth it." Malfoy didn't reappear in classes until late on Thursday morning, when the Slytherins and Gryffindors were halfway through double potions. He swaggered into the dungeon, his right arm covered in bandages and bound up in a sling, acting in Harry's opinion as though
goated means fabulous.
Dreadful battle.
Fabulous?
Does it hurt much?
Hagrid is best boy.
Putting on a brave sort of
Hagrid is a comfort character of mine. He's just a gentle giant.
Harry and Ron scowled at each other.
He big man. His big arms are there for big hugs. Based. Greatest of all time. Based.
Malfoy set up his cauldron right next to him.
Down. If only I could actually imitate an actual bass. But I can't. Because I'm a loser.
Amy, Ron went brick red. There's nothing wrong with your arm, he hissed at Malfoy. Malfoy smirked across the table. Weasley, you heard Professor Snape. Cut up these roots. Ron seized his knife, pulled Malfoy's roots towards him, and began to chop them roughly, so they were all different sizes. Professor, roared Malfoy, Weasley's mutilating my roots, sir. Snape approached their table, stared down his hooked nose at the roots, then gave Ron an unpleasant smile from beneath his long, greasy black hair. Change roots with Malfoy, Weasley. But, sir, Ron had spent the last quarter of an hour carefully shredding his own roots into exactly equal pieces. Now, said Snape, in the most dangerous voice. Ron shoved his own beautifully cut roots across the table at Malfoy, and then took up the knife again. And, sir, I'll need this shrivel-fig skinned, said Malfoy, his voice full of malicious laughter. Potter, you can skin Malfoy's shrivel-fig, said Snape, giving Harry the look of loathing he always reserved just for him. Harry took Malfoy's shrivel-fig as Ron set about...
You're not gamer enough to imitate the base.
Harry skinned the shrivel-fig.
Oh, big hugs.
Flung it back across the table at Malfoy without speaking.
All the hugs. He's a big man with the... I don't get where this is coming from. Where he's like, oh, man, I actually was in love with your mom. And I secretly was there for you. It's like, you're acting... You know you don't have to be a dick. You know that, right?
And to the Ministry of Magic.
Your father was a dick to me.
And a lasting injury like this.
So did you.
Oh, who knows if my arm will ever be the same again. So that's why you're putting it on, said Harry, accidentally beheading a dead caterpillar because his hand was shaking in anger. To try and get Hagrid sacked. Well, said Malfoy, lowering his voice to a whisper, partly, Potter, but there are other benefits too. Weasley, slice my caterpillars for me. A few cauldrons away, Neville was in trouble. Neville regularly went to pieces in potions lessons. It was his worst subject, and his great fear of Professor Snape made things 10 times worse. His potion, which was supposed to be a bright acid green, had turned...
Aww.
Wrong bottom, said Snape.
Yes. Aw, yes. Hedwig, best girl. When they ask, who is the best girl in Hogwarts... Didn't you? I'm like, do they not pick Hedwig every time? Have they graciously asked her to stop? To stop? Because she keeps winning?
Said Hermione. Please, I could help Neville put it right. I don't remember asking you to show off, Miss Granger, said Snape coldly, and Hermione went as pink as Neville. Longbottom, at the end of this lesson, we will feed a few drops of this potion to your toad and see what happens. Perhaps that will encourage you to do it properly. Snape moved away, leaving Neville breathless with fear. Help me, he moaned to Hermione. Hey, Harry, said Seamus Finnegan, leaning over to borrow Harry's brass scales. Have you heard? The Prophet has this morning. They reckon Sirius.
They disqualified her. No, Hedwig! Damn you! Politics. Damn you! Ruining another wonderful star.
He didn't really understand. The Muggles think he's just an ordinary criminal, don't they? So, she phoned the telephone hotline. By the time the Ministry of Magic got there, he was gone. Not too far from here.
A beautiful, bright star.
At Harry.
A beautiful, bright star she is.
Need something else, skinny.
Hedwig!
Malevolently, and they were fixed on Harry. He leant across the table. Thinking of trying to catch Black single-handed, Potter? Yeah, that's right, said Harry offhandedly. Malfoy's thin mouth was curved into a mean smile. Of course, if it was me, he said quietly, I'd have done something before now.
They know that she's best girl, so they just couldn't. They were like, well, we can't have her win all the time. That's what got her. That's what got her in the end.
Maybe you'd rather not risk your neck. Want to leave it to the Dementors, do you? But if it was me, I'd want revenge. I'd hunt him down myself. What are you talking about, said Harry angrily? But at that moment, Snape called.
She was too. She was playing the game every game.
Crab and Goyle laughed openly.
It wasn't fair.
He stirred his potion feverishly. Hermione was muttering instructions to him out of the corner.
Oh my god, is there a Hedwig Potter, Poggers? Let me see if there's a Hedwig Poggers.
In the corner. What did Malfoy mean? Harry muttered to Ron, as he stuck his hands under the icy jet that poured from a gargoyle's mouth. Why would I want revenge on Black? He hasn't done anything to me, yet. He's making it up, said Ron savagely. He's trying to make you do something stupid.
No.
At the end of the lesson, in sight,
no.
Snape strode over to Neville, who was cowering by his cauldron. Everyone gather round, said Snape, his black eyes glittering, and watch what happens to Longbottom.
Let's see if there's an owl, Poggers.
A shrinking solution, it will shrink to a tadpole. If, as I don't doubt, he has done it wrong, his toad is like...
Oh, they're bad.
The Gryffindors...
They're not good Poggers.
The Slytherins look...
No good Poggers. No good owl Poggers.
And dipped a small spoon into Neville's potion, which was now green.
My name.
He dropped down Trevor's throat.
Pick off. You do that. I'm glad that you got Mitz Bun to fucking do that. Oh my god. I'm so glad. I'm so glad. Oh my god. Was Vince fucking confused?
Said Snape, which wiped the smile
like, wait, what? My name's where? What's happening?
Harry, Ron, and Hermione climbed the steps to the entrance hall. Harry was still thinking about what Malfoy had said, while Ron was moving about
the Amon and Mitz's chat. I started.
Why didn't you lie, Hermione? You should have said Neville did it all by himself. Hermione didn't answer. Ron looked around. Where is she? Harry turned too. They were at the top of the steps now, watching the rest of the class pass them, heading for the Great Hall and lunch. She was right behind us, said Ron, frowning. Malfoy passed them, walking between Crabbe and Goyle. He smirked at Harry and disappeared. There she is, said Harry. Hermione was panting slightly, hurrying up the stairs. One hand was clutching her bag. The other seemed to be tucking something down the front of her robes. How did you do that, said Ron. What, said Hermione, joining them. One minute you were right behind us. The next moment, you were back at the bottom of the stairs again. What? Hermione looked slightly confused. Oh, I had to go back for something. Oh, no. A seam had split on Hermione's bag. Harry wasn't surprised. He could see that it was crammed with at least a dozen large and heavy books. Why are you carrying all those around with you? Ron asked her. You know how many subjects I'm taking, said Hermione breathlessly. Couldn't hold these for me, could you? But Ron was turning over the books she had handed him, looking at the covers. You haven't got any of these subjects today. Only Defense Against the Dark Arts this afternoon. Oh yes, said Hermione vaguely, but she packed all the books back into the bag just the same. I hope there's something good for lunch. I'm starving, she added, and she marched off towards the Great Hall. Did you get the feeling Hermione's not telling us something? Ron asked Harry. Professor Lupin wasn't there when they arrived at the first Defense Against the Dark Arts lesson. They all sat down, took out their books, quills and parchment, and were talking when he finally entered the room. Lupin smiled vaguely and placed his tatty old briefcase on the teacher's desk. He was as shabby as ever, but looked healthier than he had on the train, as though he had had a few square meals. Good afternoon, he said. Would you please put all your books back in your bags? Today's will be a practical lesson. You will only need your wands. A few curious looks were exchanged as the class put away their books. They had never had a practical defense against the dark arts before, unless you counted the memorable class last year, when their old teacher had brought a cage full of pixies to class and set them loose. Right then, said Professor Lupin, when everyone was ready, if you'd follow me. Puzzled but interested, the class got to its feet and followed Professor Lupin out of the classroom. He led them along the deserted corridor and around a corner, where the first thing they saw was Peeves the Poltergeist.
Miss Lupin.
He was floating upside down in midair and stuffing the nearest keyhole with
chewing gum. Miss Lupin.
He didn't look up until Professor Lupin was...
Miss Lupin.
Then he wiggled his curly toed feet
Lupin.
And broke into song.
Lupin. Well, thank you for coming in. I also wanted to appreciate Swabberries, or Obi, is what you call yourself, I think. I think that's what it says on there.
He would take this. To their surprise, he was still smiling. I take that
Orby.
Orby. He said pleasantly.
I said Obi. I'm so sorry.
Filch was the Hogwarts caretaker.
Schwabberries!
You wage a constant war against the
students. Do snores berries taste like snores berries?
Except below a loud wet
May the Schwartz be with you. Adorable. Merchandising. Merchandising.
He raised the wand to shoulder height and, what do I say, and pointed it at Peas. With the force of a bullet, the wad of chewing gum shot out of the keyhole and straight down Peeves' left nostril. He whirled right the way up and
zoomed also away, Peeves.
Cool, sir, said Dean Thomas in amazement. Thank you, Dean, said Professor Lupin, putting his wand away. Shall we proceed? They set off again. The class looking at shabby Professor Lupin with increased respect. He led them down a second corridor and stopped right outside the staff room door. Inside, please, said Professor Lupin, opening it and standing back. The staff room, a long paneled room full of old, mismatched chairs, was empty except from one teacher. Professor Snape was sitting in a low armchair, and he looked around as the class filled in. His eyes were glittering, and there was a nasty sneer playing around his mouth. As Professor Lupin came in and made to close the door behind him, Snape said, Leave it open, Lupin. I'd rather not witness this. He got to his feet and strode past the class, his black robes billowing behind him. At the doorway, he turned on his heel and said, Possibly no one's warned you, Lupin, but this class contains Neville Longbottom. I would advise you not to entrust him with anything difficult. Not unless
merchandising.
Neville went scarlet. Harry glared at Snape. It was bad enough that he bullied Neville in his own classes, let alone doing it in front of other teachers. Professor Lupin had raised his eyebrows. I was hoping that Neville would assist me with the first stage of the operation, he said, and I am sure he will perform it admirably. Neville's face went, if possible, even redder. Snape's lip curled, but he left, shutting the door with a snap. Now then, said Professor Lupin, beckoning the class towards the end of the room, where there was nothing except an old wardrobe in which the teachers kept their spare robes. As Professor Lupin went to stand next to it, the wardrobe gave a sudden wobble, banging off the wall. Nothing to worry about, said Professor Lupin calmly, as a few people jumped backwards in alarm. There's a boggart in there. Most people seem to feel that this is something to worry about.
Also, since you're new here, let me see if I can find it. Since you're new here, we have to do something. I forget. What is it? Oh my god. There it is. There you are.
Neville gave Professor Lupin a look of pure terror, and Seamus Finnegan eyed the now rattling doorknob apprehensively. Boggarts like dark enclosed spaces, said Professor Lupin. Wardrobes, the gap beneath beds, the cupboards under sinks. I once met one that had lodged itself in a grandfather clock. This one moved in yesterday afternoon.
The
staff would leave it to give my third year some practice. So, the first question we have must ask ourselves is, what is a boggart? Hermione put up her hand. It's a shapeshifter, she said. It can take the shape of whatever it thinks will frighten us most. Couldn't have put it better myself, said Professor Lupin, and Hermione glowed. So the boggart sitting in the darkness within has not yet assumed a form. He does not yet know what will frighten the person on the other side of the door. Nobody knows what a boggart looks like when he is alone, but when I let him out, he will immediately become whatever each of us most fears. This means, said Professor Lupin, choosing to ignore Neville's small splutter of terror, that we have a huge advantage over the boggart before we begin. Have you spotted it, Harry? Trying to answer a question with Hermione next to him, bobbing up and down on the balls of her feet with her hand in the air, was very off-putting, but Harry had a go. Because there are so many of us, it won't know what shape it should be. Precisely, said Professor Lupin, and Hermione put her hand down, looking a little disappointed. It's always best to have company when you're dealing with a boggart. He becomes confused, which should he become a headless corpse or a flesh-eating slug. I once saw a boggart make that very mistake, tried to frighten two people at once and turned himself into half a slug. Not remotely frightening. The charm, that repels a boggart is simple, yet it requires force of mind. You see, the thing that really finishes a boggart is laughter. And what you need to do is force it to assume a shape that you find amusing. We will practice the charm without wands first. After me, please. Ridiculous. Ridiculous, said the class together. Good, said Professor Lupin. Very good.
I love this scene in the movie. They did it so well.
The world alone is not enough. And this is where you come in, Neville. The wardrobe shook again, though not as much as Neville, who walked forward as though he was heading for the gallery.
This is such a fun scene,
said Professor Lupin. First things first, what would you say is the thing that frightens you most in the world? Neville's lips moved, but no noise came out. Didn't catch that, Neville. Sorry, said Professor Lupin cheerfully. Neville looked around rather wildly, as though begging someone to help him. He then said, in barely more than a whisper, Professor Snape. Nearly everyone laughed. Even Neville grinned apologetically. Professor Lupin, however, looked thoughtful. Professor Snape? Neville, I believe you live with your grandmother. Yes, said Neville nervously, but I don't want the boggart to turn into her either. No, you misunderstand me, said Professor Lupin, now smiling. I wonder, could you tell us what sort of clothes your grandmother usually wears? Neville looked startled, but said, well, always the same hat, a tall one with a stuffed vulture on top, and a long dress, green normally, and sometimes a fox fur scarf, and a handbag, prompted Professor Lupin. A big red one, said Neville. White then, said Professor Lupin. Can you picture those clothes very clearly, Neville? Can you see them in your mind's eye? Yes, said Neville uncertainly, plainly wondering what was coming next. When the boggart bursts out of this wardrobe, Neville, and sees you, it will assume the form of Professor Snape, said Lupin, and you will raise your wand, thus, and cry, ridiculous, and concentrate hard on your grandmother's clothes. All goes well, Professor Boggart Snape will be forced into that vulture-topped hat, that green dress, that big red handbag. There was a great shout of laughter. The wardrobe wobbled more violently. If Neville is successful, the boggart is likely to turn his attention to each of us in turn, said Professor Lupin. I would like all of you to take a moment now to think of the thing that scares you most and imagine how you might force it to look comical. The room went quiet. Harry thought, what scared him most in the world? His first thought was Lord Voldemort. A Voldemort returned to full strength. But before he had even started to plan a possible counterattack on a boggart Voldemort, a horrible image came floating to the surface of his mind. A rotting, glistening hand slivering back beneath a black cloak, a long, rattling breath from an unseen mouth, then a cold so penetrating it felt like drowning. Harry shivered, then looked around, hoping no one had noticed. Many people had their eyes shut tight. Ron was muttering to himself, take its legs off. Harry was sure he knew what he was on about. Ron's greatest fear was spiders. Everyone ready? Said Professor Lupin. Harry felt a lurch of fear. He wasn't ready. How could you make a Dementor less frightening? But he didn't want to ask for more time. Everyone else was nodding and rolling up their sleeves. Neville, we're going to back away, said Professor Lupin. Let you have a clear field, all right? I'll call the next person forward. Everyone back now so Neville can get a clear shot. They all retreated, backing against the walls, leaving Neville alone beside the wardrobe. He looked pale and frightened, but he had pushed up the sleeves of the robes and was holding his wand ready. On the count of three, Neville, said Professor Lupin, who was pointing his own wand at the handle of the wardrobe. One, two, three. Now! A jet of spark shot from the end of Professor Lupin's wand and hit the doorknob. The wardrobe burst open. Hook-nosed and menacing, Professor Snape stepped out, his eyes flashing at Neville. Neville backed away, his wand up, mouthing wordlessly. Snape was bearing down upon him, reaching inside his robes. Ridiculous, squeaked Neville. There was a noise like a whip crack. Snape stumbled. He was wearing a long, lace-trimmed dress and a towering hat topped with a moth-eaten vulture and swinging a huge crimson handbag from his hand. There was a roar of laughter. The boggart paused, confused, and Professor Lupin shouted, Hervati, forward! Hervati walked forward, her face set. Snape rounded on her. There was another crack, and where he had stood was a blood-stained, bandaged mummy. Its sightless face was turned to Hervati, and it began to walk towards her very slowly, dragging its feet, its stiff arms rising. Ridiculous, cried Hervati. A bandage unraveled at the mummy's feet. It became entangled, fell face forwards, and its head rolled off. Seamus, roared Professor Lupin. Seamus darted past Pavati. Crack! Where the mummy had been was a woman with floor-length black hair and a skeletal green-tinged face. A banshee. She opened her mouth wide, and an unearthly sound filled the room, a long wailing shriek which made the hair on Harry's head stand on end. Ridiculous! Shouted Seamus.
Scares me the most.
She made a rasping noise and clutched her throat. Her voice was gone. Crack! The banshee turned into a rat, which chased its tail in a circle. Then crack! Became a rattlesnake, which slithered and writhed before crack! Became a single bloody eyeball. It's confused, shouted Lupin. We're getting there, Dean. Dean hurried forward. Crack! The eyeball became a severed hand, which flipped over and began to creep along the floor like a crab. Ridiculous! Yelled Dean. There was a snap, and the hand was trapped in a mouse trap. Excellent! Ron, you next! Ron leapt forward. Crack! Quite a few people screamed. A giant spider, 6 feet tall and covered in hair, was advancing on Ron, clicking its pincers menacingly. For a moment, Harry thought Ron had frozen. Then, ridiculous, bellowed Ron, and the spider's legs vanished. It rolled over and over. Lavender Brown squealed and ran out of its way, and it came to a halt at Harry's feet. He raised his wand, ready, but... Here, shouted Professor Lupin suddenly, hurrying forward. Crack! This legless spider had vanished. For a second, everyone looked wildly around to see where it was. Then they saw a silvery, white orb hanging in the air in front of Lupin, who said, ridiculous, almost lazily. Crack! Forward, Neville, and finish him off, said Lupin, as the boggart landed on the floor as a cockroach. Crack! Snape was back. This time Neville charged forward, looking determined. Ridiculous, he shouted. And they had a split second's view of Snape in his lacy dress before Neville let out a great ha of laughter, and the boggart exploded, burst into a thousand tiny wisps of smoke, and was gone. Excellent, cried Professor Lupin, as the class broke into applause. Excellent, Neville. Well done, everyone. Let me see. 5 points to Gryffindor for every person to tackle the boggart. 10 for Neville, because he did it twice, and 5 each to Hermione and Harry. But I didn't do anything, said Harry. You and Hermione answered my questions correctly at the start of the class, Harry, Lupin said lightly. Very well. Everyone, an excellent lesson. Homework, kindly read the chapter on boggarts and summarize it for me. To be handed in on Monday. That will be all. Talking excitedly, the class left the staff room. Harry, however, wasn't feeling cheerful. Professor Lupin had deliberately stopped him tackling the boggart. Why? Was it because he'd seen Harry collapse on the train and he thought he wasn't up to much? And he thought Harry would pass out again, but no one else seemed to have noticed anything. Did you see me take that banshee? Shouted Seamus. And the hand, said Dean, waving his own around. And Snape in that hat. And my mummy. I wonder why Professor Lupin's frightened of crystal balls, said Lavender thoughtfully. That was the best defence against the dark arts lesson we've ever had, wasn't it? Said Ron excitedly, as they made their way back to the classroom to get their bags. He seems a very good teacher, said Hermione approvingly. But I wish I could have had a turn with the boggart. What would it have been for you, said Ron, sniggering. A piece of homework that only got 9 out of 10? In no time at all, Defence Against the Dark Arts had become most people's favourite class. Only Draco Malfoy and his gang of Slytherins had anything bad to say about Professor Lupin. Look at the state of his robes, Malfoy would say in a loud whisper as Professor Lupin passed. He dresses like our old house elf. But no one else cared that Professor Lupin's robes were patched and frayed. His next few lessons were just as interesting as the first. After boggarts, they studied redcap, nasty little goblin-like creatures
that lurked
wherever there had been bloodshed, in the dungeons of castles and the potholes of deserted battlefields, waiting to bludgeon those who had got lost. From redcaps, they moved on to kappas, creepy water dwellers that looked like scaly monkeys with webbed hands itching to strangle unwitting waders in their ponds. Harry only wished he was as happy with some of his other classes. Worst of all was potions. Snape was in a particularly vindictive mood these days, and no one was in any doubt why. The story of the boggart assuming Snape's shape and the way that Neville had dressed it in his grandmother's clothes had travelled through the school like wildfire. Snape didn't seem to find it funny. His eyes flashed menacingly at the very mention of Professor Lupin's name, and he was bullying Neville worse than ever. Harry was also grown to dread the hours he spent in Professor Trelawney's stifling tower room, deciphering lopsided shapes and symbols, trying to ignore the way Professor Trelawney's enormous eyes filled with tears every time she looked at him. He couldn't like Professor Trelawney, even though she was treated and she was treated with respect bordering on reverence by many of the class. Pavati Patil and Lavender Brown had taken to haunting Professor Trelawney's tower room at lunchtimes and always returned with annoyingly superior looks on their faces, as though they knew things the others didn't. They had also started using hushed voices whenever they spoke to Harry, as though he was in his deathbed. Nobody really liked Care of Magical Creatures, which, after the action-packed first class, had become extremely dull. Hagrid seemed to have lost his confidence. They were now spending lesson after lesson learning how to look after flobberworms, which had to be some of the most boring creatures in existence. Why would anyone bother looking after them, said Ron, after yet another hour of poking shredded lettuce down the flobberworm's slimy throat. At the start of October, however, Harry had something else to occupy him, something so enjoyable it made up for his unsatisfactory classes. The Quidditch season was approaching, and Oliver Wood, captain of the Gryffindor team, called a meeting one Thursday Quidditch. Evening to discuss tactics for the new season.
Oh, what's that?
There were seven.
What are you? What emote is that? Bone.
Whose job it was to score goals by
it's a bone.
A red football-sized ball.
Thank you for the thrown bone.
At each end of the pitch.
I need it.
Two beaters who were equipped with heavy bats to repel the bludgers. Two heavy black balls which zoomed around trying to attack the players. A keeper who defended the goalposts, and the seeker who had the hardest job of all, that of catching the golden snitch. A tiny winged walnut.
Dead crewmate. Oh no.
Whose capture ended the game and earned the seeker
oh, no. 150
points.
Boom 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 boom. Was a burly 17-year-old, boom 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 boom.
There was a quiet sort of desperation.
Where is it? Where is it? There it is. There it is.
Inspiration in his voice as he addressed his six yellow team members in the chilly changing rooms on the edge of the darkened Quidditch pitch. This is our last chance, my last chance, to win the Quidditch Cup, he told them, striding up and down in front of them. I'll be leaving at the end of this year. I'll never get another shot at it. Gryffindor haven't won for 7 years now. Okay, so we've had the worst luck in the world. Injuries, then the tournament getting called off last year. Wood swallowed as though the memory still brought a lump to his throat. We also know we're the best ruddy team in the school, he said, punching a fist into his other hand, the old manic glint back in his eye. We've got three superb chasers, Wood pointed at Alicia Spinett, Angelina Johnson and Katie Bell. We've got two unbeatable beaters. Stop it, Oliver. You're embarrassing us, said Fred and George Weasley together, pretending to blush. And we've got a seeker who has never failed to win us a match, Wood rumbled, glaring at Harry with a kind of furious pride. And me, he added, as an afterthought. We think you're very good too, Oliver, said George. Cracking keeper, said Fred. The point is, Wood went on, resuming his pacing. The Quidditch Cup should have had our name on it these last 2 years. Ever since Harry joined the team, I thought the thing was in the bag, but we haven't got it. And this year's the last chance we'll get to finally see our name on the thing. Wood spoke so dejectedly that even Fred and George looked sympathetic. Oliver, this year's our year, said Fred. We'll do it, Oliver, said Angelina. Definitely, said Harry. Full of determination, the team started training sessions, 3 evenings a week. The weather was getting colder and wetter, the nights darker, but no amount of mud, wind or rain could tarnish Harry's wonderful vision of finally winning the huge silver Quidditch Cup. Harry returned to the Gryffindor common room one evening after training, cold and stiff, but pleased with the way practice had gone, to find the room buzzing excitedly. What's happened? He asked Ron and Hermione, who were sitting in two of the best chairs by the fireside and completing some star charts for astronomy. First Hogsmeade weekend, said Ron, pointing at a notice that had appeared on the battered old notice board. End of October. Halloween. Excellent, said Fred, who had followed Harry through the portrait hole. I need to visit Zonko's. I'm nearly out of stink pellets. Harry threw himself into a chair beside Ron, his high spirits ebbing away. Hermione seemed to read his mind. Harry, I'm sure you'll be able to go next time, she said. They're bound to catch Black soon. He's been sighted once already. Perhaps not fool enough to try anything in Hogsmeade, said Ron. Ask McGonagall if you can go this time, Harry. The next one might not be for ages. Ron, said Hermione, Harry's supposed to stay in school. He can't be the only third year left behind, said Ron. Ask McGonagall. Go on, Harry. Yeah, I think I will, said Harry, making up his mind. Hermione opened her mouth to argue, but at that moment, Crookshanks leapt lightly onto her lap. A large dead spider was dangling from his mouth. "Does he have to eat that in front of us?" said Ron, scowling. "Clever, Crookshanks. Did you catch that all by yourself?" said Hermione. Crookshanks slowly chewed up the spider, his yellow eyes fixed insolently on Ron. "Just keep him over there, that's all," said Ron irritably, turning back to his star chart. "I've got Scabbers asleep in my bag." Harry yawned. He really wanted to go to bed, but he still had his own star chart to complete. He pulled his bag towards him, took out parchment, ink and quill, and started work. "You can copy mine if you like," said Ron, labelling his last star with a flourish and shoving the chart towards Harry. Hermione, who disapproved of copying, pursed her lips, but didn't say anything. Crookshanks was still staring unblinkingly at Ron, flicking the end of his bushy tail. Then, without warning, he pounced. "Oi!" Ron roared, seizing his bag as Crookshanks sank four sets of claws deeply into it and began tearing ferociously. "Get off, you stupid animal!" Ron tried to pull the bag away from Crookshanks, but Crookshanks clung on, spitting and slashing. "Ron, don't hurt him," squealed Hermione. The whole common room was watching. Ron whirled the bag around, Crookshanks still clinging onto it, and Scabbers came flying out of the top. "Catch that cat," Ron yelled as Crookshanks freed himself from the remnants of the bag, sprang over the table and chased after the terrified Scabbers. George Weasley made a lunge for Crookshanks, but missed. Scabbers streaked away through those 20 pairs of legs and shot beneath an old chest of drawers. Crookshanks skidded to a halt, crouched low on his bandy legs, and started making furious swipes beneath the chest of drawers with his front paw. Ron and Hermione hurried over. Hermione grabbed Crookshanks around the middle and heaved him away. Ron threw himself onto his stomach, and with great difficulty pulled Scabbers out by the tail. "Look at him," he said furiously to Hermione, dangling Scabbers in front of her.
"Oh, hey,
you keep that
thank you
him.
For the raid."
"Crookshanks doesn't understand it's wrong," said Hermione, her voice shaking. "All cats chase rats, Ron." "There's nothing funny about that animal," said Ron. He was trying to persuade a frantically wriggling Scabbers back into his pocket.
"Thank you for the raid.
Scabbers was in my bag."
"Thank you. I'm also getting tired."
"Smell him, Ron.
That's the question. Who are we gonna raid?"
Ignoring the people around, he was starting to giggle.
"Because I'm starting to fall asleep in my chair. I'm starting to fall asleep, everybody. I'm getting tired."
Hermione next day. He barely talked to her all through Herbology, even though he, Harry, and Hermione were working together on the same puffer pod. "How's Scabbers?" Hermione asked timidly, as they stripped fat pink pods from the plants and emptied the shining beans into a wooden pail. "He's hiding at the bottom of my bed, shaking," said Ron angrily, missing the pail and scattering beans over the greenhouse floor. "Careful, Weasley, careful," cried Professor Sprout, as the beans burst into bloom before their very eyes. They had transfiguration next. Harry, who had resolved to ask Professor McGonagall after the lesson whether he could go into Hogsmeade with the rest, joined the queue outside the classroom, trying to decide how he was going to argue his case. He was distracted, however, by a disturbance in the front of the line. Lavender Brown seemed to be crying. Havati had her arm around her and was explaining something to Dean Thomas, who was looking very serious. "What's the matter, Lavender?" said Hermione.
"Okay, have a good one."
"She got a letter from home this morning."
"Get some rest."
"Her rabbit, Binky, has been killed by a fox." "Oh," said Hermione. "I'm sorry, Lavender." "I should have known," said Lavender tragically. "You know what day it is?" "The 16th of October. That thing you're dreading. It will happen on the 16th of October, remember?" She was right. She was right. The whole class was gathered around Lavender now. Seamus shook his head seriously. Hermione hesitated.
"You weren't dreading that?"
"Said, you were dreading Binky being killed by a fox." "Well, not necessarily by a fox," said Lavender, looking up at Hermione with streaming eyes. "But I was obviously dreading him dying, wasn't I?" "Oh," said Hermione. She paused again. Then, "was Binky an old rabbit?"
"No,"
said Lavender. "He's only a baby."
"Good night."
Lavender's shoulders. "But then, why would you dread him dying?" said Hermione. Havati glared at her. "Well, look at it logically," said Hermione, turning to the rest of the group. "I mean, Binky didn't even die today, did he? Lavender just got the news today." Lavender wailed loudly. "And she can't have been dreading it because it's come as a real shock." "Don't mind Hermione, Lavender," said Ron loudly. "She doesn't think other people's pets matter very much." Professor McGonagall opened the classroom door at that moment, which was perhaps lucky. Hermione and Ron were looking daggers at each other, and when they got into class, they seated themselves either side of
Harry. Sorry, work calls. I wish you a great sleep. No.
Harry still hadn't decided what he was going to say.
No.
When the bell rang at the end of the lesson, but it was she.
I will miss my friends. I understand they must go to bed or they must go to work, but I still miss them. Oh.
No visiting the village.
Oh.
So don't forget.
Akio, Bob.
I think I've lost.
Hold on. What if I can't get it up?
Said Professor McGonagall. You seem to think it was safer. Oh, well, that's
Wingardium Leviosa.
How for now? One missed at Harry. Oh.
Oh, goodness, Ron.
Go for it, Harry, said Ron stubbornly. Harry waited for the rest of the class to disappear, then headed nervously to Professor McGonagall's desk. Yes, Potter. Harry took a deep breath. Professor, my aunt and uncle forgot to sign my form, he said. Professor McGonagall looked over her square spectacles at him, but didn't say anything. So, do you think it would be all right? I mean, will it be okay if I go to Hogsmeade? Professor McGonagall looked down and began shuffling papers on her desk. I'm afraid not, Potter, she said. You heard what they said. No form, no visiting the village. That's the rule. But, Professor, my aunt and uncle, you know they're muggles. They don't really understand about Hogwarts forms and stuff, Harry said, while Ron edged him on with vigorous nods. If you said I could go, but I don't see, said Professor McGonagall, standing up and piling her papers neatly into a drawer. The form clearly states that the parent or guardian must give permission. She turned to look at him with an odd expression on her face. Was it pity? I'm sorry, Potter, but that's my final word. You'd better hurry, or you'll be late for your next lesson. There was nothing to be done. Ron called Professor McGonagall a lot of names that greatly annoyed Hermione. Hermione assumed an all-for-the-best expression that made Ron even angrier, and Harry had to endure everyone in the class talking loudly and happily about what they were going to do first once they got to Hogsmeade. There's always the feast, said Ron, in an effort to cheer Harry up. You know, the Halloween feast in the evening. Yeah, said Harry gloomily. Great. The Halloween feast was always good.
Sweet.
It would taste
cool.
A lot better if he was coming to it after a day in Hogsmeade with everyone else. Nothing anyone said made him feel any better about being left behind. Dean Thomas, who was good with a quote.
No, I'd be fine without going to a town.
Harry had already told Professor McGonagall he hadn't had it signed. That was no good.
I'm never good at going to places. I always waste my money in places that they shouldn't be wasted on, and I waste the day just being so surprised by everything.
They make a fuss about Hogsmeade, but I assure you, Harry, it's not all.
Then after thinking about it, I'm like, man, I could have just stayed at home and played video games and would have had the same fun.
Shrieking Shack's always worth
or more.
Apart from that, you're missing nothing. On Halloween morning, Harry awoke with the rest and went down to breakfast, feeling thoroughly depressed, though doing his best to act normally. We'll bring you lots of sweets back from Honeydukes, said Hermione, looking desperately sorry for him. Yeah, loads, said Ron. He and Hermione had finally forgotten their squabble about Crookshanks in the face of Harry's disappointment. Don't worry about me, said Harry, in what he hoped was an offhand voice. I'll see you at the feast. Have a good time. He accompanied them to the entrance hall, where Filch, the caretaker, was standing inside the front doors, checking off names against a long list, peering suspiciously into every face, and making sure that no one was sneaking out who shouldn't be. Staying here, Potter, shouted Malfoy, who was standing in line with Crabbe and Goyle, scared of passing the Dementors. Harry ignored him and made his solitary way up the marble staircase, through the deserted corridors, and back to Gryffindor Tower. Password, said the fat lady, jerking out of a doze. Fortuna Major, said Harry listlessly. The portrait swung open, and he climbed through the hole into the common room. It was full of chattering first and second years, and a few older students who had obviously visited Hogsmeade so often the novelty had worn off. Harry! Harry! Hi, Harry! It was Colin Creevy, a second year who was deeply in awe of Harry and never missed an opportunity to speak to him. Aren't you going to Hogsmeade, Harry? Why not, hey? Look, Colin looked eagerly around at his friends. You can come and sit with us if you like, Harry. No thanks, Colin, said Harry, who wasn't in the mood to have a lot of people staring avidly at the scar on his forehead. I've got to go to the library. Got to get some work done. After that, he had no choice but to turn right round and head back out to the portrait hole again. What was the point of waking me up? The fat lady called grumpily after him as he walked away. Harry wandered dispiritedly towards the library, but halfway there, he changed his mind. He didn't feel like working. He turned around and came face to face with Filch, who had obviously not seen off the last, who had just seen off the last of the Hogsmeade visitors. "What are you doing?" Filch snarled suspiciously. "Nothing," said Harry truthfully. "Nothing," spat Filch, his jowls quivering unpleasantly. "A likely story. Sneaking around on your own? Why aren't you in Hogsmeade buying stink pellets and belch powder and whizzing worms like the rest of those nasty little friends?" Harry shrugged. "Well, get back to your common room where you belong," snapped Filch. And he stood glaring until Harry had passed out of sight. But Harry didn't go back to the common room. He climbed a staircase, thinking vaguely of visiting the owlery to see Hedwig, and was walking along another corridor when a voice from inside one of the rooms said, "Harry!" Harry doubled back to see who had spoken, and met Professor Lupin, looking around his office door. "What are you doing?" said Lupin, in a very different voice from Filch. "Where are Ron and Hermione?" "Hogsmeade," said Harry.
"Yeah, look at that bee."
"Ah," said Lupin.
"Look at that bee."
Harry for a moment.
"Look at that bee.
I've just taken delivery of a Griffin, Grindylow, for our next lesson." "A what?" said Harry. He followed Lupin into his office. In the corner stood a very large tank of water. A sickly green creature with sharp little horns had its face pressed against the glass.
"Create a new file."
"Water demon," said Lupin, surveying the Grindylow thoughtfully. "We shouldn't have much difficulty with him.
Break his
grip. You notice the abnormally long fingers, strong but very brittle." The Grindylow bared its green teeth and then buried itself in a tangle of weed in a corner. "Cup of tea," Lupin said, looking around for his kettle. "I was just thinking of making one." "All right," said Harry awkwardly. Lupin tapped the kettle with his wand and a blast of steam issued suddenly from the spout. "Sit down," said Lupin, taking the lid off a dusty bin. "I've only got tea bags, I'm afraid, but I dare say you've had enough of tea leaves." Harry looked at him. Lupin's eyes were twinkling. "How did you know about that?" Harry asked. "Professor McGonagall told me," said Lupin, passing Harry a chipped mug of tea. "You're not worried, are you?" "No," said Harry. He thought for a moment of telling Lupin about the dog he'd seen in Magnolia Crescent, but decided not to. He didn't want Lupin to think he was a coward, especially since Lupin already seemed to think he couldn't cope with a boggart. Something of Harry's thoughts seemed to have shown on his face, because Lupin said, "Anything worrying you, Harry?" "No," Harry lied. He drank a bit of tea and watched the Grindylow brandishing a fist at him. "Yes," he said suddenly, putting his tea down on Lupin's desk. "You know that day we fought the boggart?" "Yes," said Lupin slowly. "Why didn't you let me fight it?" said Harry abruptly. Lupin raised his eyebrows. I would have thought that was obvious, Harry," he said, sounding surprised. Harry, who had expected Lupin to deny that he'd done any such thing, was taken aback. "Why?" he said again. "Well," said Lupin, frowning slightly, "I assumed that if the boggart faced you, it would assume the shape of Lord Voldemort." Harry stared. Not only was this the last answer he'd expected, but Lupin had said Voldemort's name. The only person Harry had ever heard say the name aloud, apart from himself, was Professor Dumbledore. "Clearly, I was wrong," said Lupin, still frowning at Harry, "but I didn't think it a good idea for Lord Voldemort to materialize in the staff room. I imagine that people would panic." "I did think of Voldemort first," said Harry honestly, "but then I remembered those Dementors." "I see," said Lupin thoughtfully. "Well, well, I'm impressed." He smiled slightly at the look of surprise on Harry's face. "That suggests that what you fear most of all is fear. Very wise, Harry." Harry didn't know what to say to that, so he drank some more tea. "So you've been thinking that I didn't believe you are capable of fighting the boggart," said Lupin shrewdly. "Well, yeah," said Harry. He was suddenly feeling a lot happier. "Professor Lupin, you know the Dementors." He was interrupted by a knock on the door. "Come in," called Lupin. The door opened and in came Snape. He was carrying a goblet, which was smoking faintly, and stopped at the sight of Harry, his black eyes narrowing. "Ah, Severus," said Lupin, smiling. "Thanks very much. Could you leave it here on the desk for me?" Snape set the smoking goblet down, his eyes wandering between Harry and Lupin. "I was just showing Harry my Grindylow," said Lupin pleasantly, pointing at the tank. "Fascinating," said Snape, without looking at it. "You should drink that directly, Lupin." "Yes, yes, I will," said Lupin. "I made an entire cauldron full," Snape continued, "if you need more. I should probably take some again tomorrow. Thanks very much, Severus." "Not at all," said Snape, but there was a look in his eye Harry didn't like. He backed out of the room, unsmiling and watchful. Harry looked curiously at the goblet, Lupin smiled. Professor Snape has very kindly concocted a potion for me, he said. I have never been much of a potion brewer, and this one in particular is complex. He picked up the goblet and sniffed it. Pity sugar makes it useless, he added, taking a sip and shuddering. Why? Harry began. Lupin looked at him and answered the unfinished question. I've been feeling a bit off colour, he said. This potion is the only thing that helps. I am very lucky to be working alongside Professor Snape. There aren't many wizards who are up to making it. Professor Lupin took another sip, and Harry had a mad urge to knock the goblet out of his hands. Professor Snape's very interested in the dark arts, he blurted out. Really? Said Lupin, looking only mildly interested as he took another gulp of potion. Some people reckon, Harry hesitated, then plunged recklessly on. Some people reckon he'd do anything to get the Defense Against the Dark Arts job. Lupin drained the goblet and pulled a face. Disgusting, he said. Well, Harry, I better get back to work. I'll see you at the feast later. Right, said Harry, putting his empty teacup down. The empty goblet was still smoking. There you go, said Ron. We got as much as we could carry. A shower of brilliantly coloured sweets fell into Harry's lap. It was dusk, and Ron and Hermione had just turned up in the common room, pink-faced from the cold wind and looking as though they'd had the time of their lives. Thanks, said Harry, picking up a packet of tiny black pepper ints. What's Hogsmeade like? Where did you go? By the sound of it, everywhere. Dervish and Banjis, the wizarding equipment shop, Zonko's joke shop, into the free broomsticks for foaming mugs of hot butter beer, and many places besides. The post office, Harry, and had 200 owls, all sitting on shelves, all colour-coded depending on how fast you want your letter to go there. Honeydukes have got a new kind of fudge. They were giving out free samples. There's a bit, look. We think we saw an ogre. Honestly, they get all sorts of the free broomstick. Wish we could have brought you some butter beer. Really warms you up. What did you do? Said Hermione, looking anxious. Did you get any work done? No, said Harry. Lupin made me a cup of tea in his office, and then Snape came in. He told them all about the goblet. Ron's mouth fell open. Lupin drank it, he gasped. Is he mad? Hermione checked her watch. But we better go down, you know. The feast will be starting in 5 minutes. They hurried through the portrait hole and into the crowd, still discussing Snape. But if he, you know, Hermione dropped her voice, glancing nervously around. He was trying to poison Lupin. He wouldn't have done it in front of Harry. Yeah, maybe, said Harry, as they reached the entrance hall and crossed into the great hall. It had been decorated with hundreds and hundreds of candle-filled pumpkins, a cloud of fluttering live bats, and many flaming orange streamers, which were swimming lazily across the stormy ceiling like brilliant water snakes. The food was delicious. Even Hermione and Ron, who were full to bursting with honeydew sweets, managed second helpings of everything. Harry kept glancing at the staff table. Professor Lupin looked cheerful, and as well as he ever did, he was talking animatedly to tiny little Professor Flitwick, the charms teacher. Harry moved his eyes along the table to the place where Snape sat. Was he imagining it? Or were Snape's eyes flickering towards Lupin more often than was natural? The feast finished with an entertainment provided by the Hogwarts ghost. They popped out of the walls and tables.
Yeah, because he wants to make sure that the fucking potion went well.
The Gryffindor ghost had a great success with a reenactment of his own botched beheading. It had been such a good evening that Harry's good mood couldn't even be spoiled by Malfoy.
It's really funny. He always wanted the
Harry, Ron, and Hermione followed the
job of Defense Against the Dark Arts. But it's very funny. He's really doesn't seem like he's great at it. I don't know. He might be good, great at both potions and Defense Against the Dark Arts. He might be good at Defense Against the Dark Arts. Hello, Steady.
And then a silence fell over the crowd. From the front first, so that a chill seemed to spread down the corridor, they heard Percy say, in a suddenly sharp voice, "Somebody get Professor Dumbledore, quick!" People's heads turned. Those at the back were standing on tiptoe. "What's going on?" said Ginny, who had just arrived. Next moment, Professor Dumbledore was there, sweeping towards the portrait.
Let's see.
The doors squeezed together to let him through, and Harry, Ron, and Hermione moved closer to see what the trouble was.
Wake up in the morning feeling like a bum.
The fat lady
had been slashed
so viciously that strips of canvas littered the floor, great chunks of it have been torn away completely.
Don't get me, I'm a rabbit.
One quick look.
Don't get me, I'm a rabbit.
To see Professor McGonagall,
baby,
hurrying towards him.
Damn, baby.
We need to find her, said Dumbledore.
Wanna get a little pet? Gonna get a little pet. I'm a little bunny.
Lady, you'll be lucky, said a cackling voice. It was Peeves, the poltergeist, bobbing over the crowd and looking delighted, as he always did, at the sight of wrecked.
Who are we going to raid?
Said Dumbledore calmly, and Peeves' grin faded a little. He didn't dare taunt Dumbledore. Instead, he adopted an oily voice that was no better than his cackle.
Yes, we can raid.
Ashamed, your headship, sir. Doesn't want to be seen. She's a horrible mess.
I guess we can raid D20.
On the fourth floor, sir, dodging between the trees, crying something dreadful, he said happily. Poor thing, he added unconvincingly. Did she say, who did it? Said Dumbledore quietly. Oh, yes, Professor Head, said Peeves, with the air of one cradling a large bombshell in his arms. He got very angry when she wouldn't let him in, you see. Peeves flipped over and grinned at
Is this an ant persona? No, it's a bee.
That serious black. Professor Dumbledore set all the Gryffindors back to the Great Hall, where they were joined 10 minutes later by the students from Hufflepuff, Ravenclaw, and Slytherin, who all looked extremely confused. The teachers and I need to conduct a thorough search of the castle, Professor Dumbledore told them.
Oh, it makes Professor more sense. Yeah, it's a giant bee. It's the galactic bees fursona.
Who am I gonna raid?
Any
disturbance should be reported to me immediately, he added to Percy, who was looking immensely proud.
Who am I gonna raid?
Professor Dumbledore paused, about to leave the hall, and said, oh,
I'm
yes.
getting
Are
sleepy.
One casual wave of his wand, and the long table
I'm a sweepy
the
man.
And stood themselves against the walls.
You have Another someone? Give me their name.
Sleeping bags.
Gosh well, dang it, give me their name.
The hall immediately began to buzz excitedly.
It's meme time, meme time.
Everyone into their sleeping bags, shouted Percy. Come on now, no more talking. Lights out in 10 minutes.
Give me their gosh dang name. Give me their name.
And dragged them into a corner. Do you think Black's still in the castle? Hermione whispered anxiously. Dumbledore obviously thinks he might be, said Ron. Very lucky he picked tonight, you know, said Hermione, as they climbed fully dressed into their sleeping bags and propped themselves on their elbows to talk. For one night, we weren't in the tower.
Okay.
I reckon he's lost track of time. Being said Ron. Didn't realize it was Halloween. Otherwise, he'd be bursting in here.
Natural.
All around them, people were asking each other the same question.
Alright.
Did he get in? Maybe he knows how to.
Alright, guys. Thank you guys so much for the wonderful time. Thank you guys for being amazing. Thank you guys so much for the beautiful time that you have given me. Thank you guys for listening to Harry Potter. Thank you guys so much for being amazing. Thank you guys for being stupendous. I know it's so easy for you guys. Gosh darn it. Gosh dang. Gosh dang, thank you so much for being so beautiful. Sweet dreams, goat. Fair enough. Sweet dreams it shall be. And thank you guys for being so amazing. Thank you guys for chilling out with me, even though I know I'm not that interesting. I'm glad that I can give you guys a little bit of something. This is what I got done in a night. And I get a little bit of shading done. And he's a beef bee. He's a beefy bee. So, all right, guys. Thank you guys so much for being amazing. Thank you guys for being stupendous. I will see you guys next time. Na-na. Bam.